Pomegranate Press Limited presents The Fugitive Recaptured, an audio book by Ed Robertson. Narrated by yours truly, Barry Morse, Jacqueline Scott, and Roy Huggins.
The Fugitive.
Foreword. I've been lucky enough to have been consistently engaged in some branch or other of the entertainment industry for nearly 60 years. And I've found that it isn't always the case that if you're involved in something which is hugely popular, that it's necessarily also highly enjoyable. But The Fugitive was, for me, immensely enjoyable. Not only because of its great and lasting popularity, but even more because of the splendid group of people whom it brought together. Quinn Martin, who formulated the structure of the whole thing. The writers, who contributed so many marvellously diverse scripts. Our brilliantly skillful and tireless crew. And, of course, our hero, dear David Janssen. 30 years on, the series has become a classic of its kind. All too many of our colleagues are no longer with us, but I meet every day enthusiastic young people who are thrilled and moved today by a drama that we made long before they were born. By the scrupulous research and the tasteful presentation of his book, Ed Robertson has created a brilliant record of one of the outstanding achievements of television history, of which I, for one, am proud to have been a part. It'll fascinate viewers of all generations. Barry Morse, February 1993.
An introduction by Stephen King. The Fugitive was a groundbreaking television series because it featured a hero who was totally powerless. Everybody who watched The Fugitive could identify with Richard Kimball. David Janssen spoke for a whole generation of people. Kids like me who grew up feeling slightly alienated from all the values of our parents. We felt like fugitives in a sense. The Greek chorus that was heard from one end of this country to another was, "Turn that goddamn thing down." Our music changed, our mores changed, and I looked at that guy and I said, "Yes, I feel like him. I know what it's like to be falsely accused." And I loved the way Kimball lived, to be able to move from town to town like that. He was the sort of character that people at the time wanted to sublimate themselves in. Lieutenant Gerard, on the other hand, really scared me as a kid. Barry Morse was so good, he brought an element of reality to Gerard that a lot of TV characters didn't have. Whereas most series characters remain emotionally static, Gerard actually seemed to grow less and less tightly wrapped as the show continued. Gerard was completely nuts. At least I thought so. Kimball had made him crazy, and as The Fugitive went on, you could just see him heading further and further into Freako land. The Fugitive broke all stereotypes. It was at the time, and still is, when you see the reruns, absolutely the best series done on American television. There was nothing better than The Fugitive. It just turned everything on its head.
Prologue. One of the most popular television programs of the 1960s endeared audiences worldwide to one man and his struggle to clear himself of a crime he did not commit. The Fugitive. On Tuesday, September the 17th, 1963, at 10 p.m., William Conrad's stern but soothing voice introduced television viewers to Dr. Richard Kimball. David Janssen, a respected pediatrician from Stafford, Indiana, who had been convicted of murdering his wife, Helen, 2 years earlier. For months, the Kimballs had argued over Helen's unwillingness to adopt a child, after learning that she could not bear her own. And one night, after storming out of the house following another quarrel, Dr. Kimball was just returning home when he witnessed Fred Johnson, Bill Raisch, a fiendish-looking one-armed man, running from the vicinity of his house. After nearly running over Johnson with his car, Dr. Kimball raced into his home and found his wife Helen murdered. Although Kimball believed it was Johnson who killed his wife, no one else actually witnessed the murder. No neighbors heard or saw Johnson, and the police, despite the thorough investigation of Lieutenant Philip Gerard, Barry Morse, found no trace of the man. Based on circumstantial evidence, the jury found Dr. Kimball guilty and sentenced him to die in the electric chair. After several failed appeals, Kimball, accompanied by Lieutenant Gerard, boarded a train headed for the death house. Kimball glanced into the train window but saw only the darkness of the night. The end was only moments away. But, intoned William Conrad, in that darkness, fate moves its huge hand. The train derailed, and in the ensuing confusion, Kimball escaped. On that September night, he began a lonely, paranoid flight from the law and a desperate search for the one-armed man, the only person who could clear his name and save him from execution. An exile, Kimball drifted from place to place, from rural town to big city, in search of any clue that could lead him to the man with one arm. Like Jean Valjean, his counterpart in Victor Hugo's Les Misérables, Kimball faced a particular nemesis, the implacable Lieutenant Gerard, whose relentless search for the fugitive soon became an all-consuming obsession. Each week, tens of millions of television viewers watched The Fugitive and hoped that Kimball could elude the authorities long enough to find the one-armed man and clear his own name. The quest for exoneration reached a dramatic climax on August the 29th, 1967, when Kimball confronted the one-armed man in the series' final primetime episode. Over 70% of the total TV audience in the United States alone watched The Fugitive that night, a figure which remains one of the highest-rated broadcasts in American television history. But would you believe that The Fugitive nearly never made it to the television screen at all? Although he never once doubted that audiences would accept his idea, the series creator, Roy Huggins, abandoned the fugitive for nearly 2 years because everyone he consulted, friends, colleagues, his lawyer, even his dentist, found the idea absolutely repulsive. Huggins finally found a lone supporter in ABC's president, Leonard Goldenson, who declared the fugitive the best idea for a television series I've ever heard, after Huggins presented the concept at a meeting with ABC executives in 1962. But the series still faced nothing but opposition before it premiered in September of 1963. Even ABC itself was split. One programming vice president denounced The Fugitive as, quote, a slap in the face of the American judicial system, unquote, just moments after Goldenson had approved the program. But television audiences embraced The Fugitive because of two factors everyone who opposed the idea of the series had completely overlooked. First, Richard Kimball is innocent, as William Conrad reminds us at the beginning of every episode. And second, this was a TV series about a hero who was totally powerless, and people identified with him, as novelist Stephen King observed about his favorite TV show. It, Stephen King said, it turned everything on its head. Indeed, in a world populated by winners like Perry Mason, Dr. Kimball was a loser, a man condemned by society with no recourse to prove his innocence. Anyone who watched The Fugitive could identify with him because everyone has felt at some time or another the sting of a false accusation or an unjust punishment. The thing that gets me the angriest is being blamed for something I didn't do, said series writer and producer George Eckstein. "I'm sure this is true for a great many people," he went on. "The Fugitive is the ultimate version of that syndrome. Kimball's life is on the line for something he didn't do." This series tapped a nerve. A lot of us go around with that sting in our psyche, feeling that somehow people think we're one thing when we're really another. In January 1990, the Arts and Entertainment Cable Television Network, A&E, revitalized The Fugitive by introducing the Emmy Award-winning drama to a new generation of viewers. And since its revival, The Fugitive has spawned at least two fan clubs in this country, one named On the Run and the other simply The Fugitives, and a third in France, the David Janssen Appreciation Society. New Ventures Video has made the series available on home videos, and Warner Brothers, in August of 1993, released an exciting, smashingly successful feature film version, starring Harrison Ford as The Fugitive and Tommy Lee Jones as Gerard. And that immediately set records at the box office. 30 years after its network premiere, The Fugitive remains as magnetic as ever. The tremendously positive audience response to The Fugitive compelled A&E in 1992 to retain their rights to the program for another 3 years. In April of 1993, TV Guide, as part of its 40th anniversary salute to the all-time best of TV, honored The Fugitive as the best dramatic series of the 1960s. In July of 1993, Entertainment Weekly ranked The Fugitive number 6 among 101 shows in its poll of all-time classic programs. But the most fitting testimony to The Fugitive's lasting appeal occurred in August of 1993, when the NBC television network, responding quickly to the fury of the Fugitive phenomenon, broadcast the first and final episodes of this landmark series in prime time. For 13 years, the final episode of The Fugitive held the record for the highest-rated broadcast in television history, although that record has been twice eclipsed, first by Dallas in 1980, and then by MASH in 1983, The Fugitive continues to leave its imprint on television. Kimball's exoneration in the final episode marked the first instance of a television series resolving its premise. Since The Fugitive left the air in 1967, many other successful television programs have followed its lead by ending their network runs with a definitive concluding episode. Programs such as The Mary Tyler Moore Show, MASH, Dallas, Cheers, even The Tonight Show starring Johnny Carson. In addition, The Fugitive has proliferated dozens of similar programs featuring a wandering, disadvantaged protagonist who helps people. Run for Your Life, The Invaders, The Immortal, Kung Fu, The Incredible Hulk, Hot Pursuit, and The Golden Years, to name a few. Many popular TV programs such as Get Smart and It's Gary Shandling's Show have parodied The Fugitive, while other shows have playfully alluded to it, such as an announcement paging Dr. Richard Kimball on St. Elsewhere, and a one-armed character named Philip Gerard in Twin Peaks. The Fugitive's influence extends even further. It enhanced the already solid reputations of series creator Roy Huggins and executive producer Quinn Martin, two of the most influential figures in the history of television drama. And it provided a springboard for many talented writers and producers and directors, including Richard Levinson and William Link, Glenn A. Larson, Hampton Francher, Bert Brinkerhoff, Lou Antonio, Burt Metcalf, Walter Brough, Bob Rubin, Ken Gilbert, Steve Lodge, Richard Donner, Mark Rydell, and Sidney Pollack. It boasted a litany of prominent and talented guest stars, too, such as Suzanne Pleshette, Angie Dickinson, Ron Howard, Carol O'Connor, Brian Keith, Bruce Dern, Telly Savalas, Leslie Nielsen, Carol Rossen, Jack Klugman, Robert Duvall, Ossie Davis, Lee Grant, Kurt Russell, Greg Morris, Sherry North, Richard Anderson, Diane Baker, William Shatner, Debbie Coleman, James Tarantino, Carol Lawrence, Donald Pleasance, Edward Asner, Mickey Rooney, Beau Bridges, Charles Bronson, and Jack Lord. And it made David Jensen a star. The Fugitive wasn't just a highly watched and hugely profitable television series. It was an international phenomenon. Every Tuesday night for 4 years, people of all ages and over 70 countries dropped whatever they were doing at 10 o'clock at night and took up the cause of Dr. Richard Kimball. Not since Lucy Ricardo gave birth to little Ricky in 1953 had one television character so seized the collective human spirit. Whenever Kimball felt fear, we held our breath. And when he escaped unharmed, we sighed in relief. Whenever Kimball looked over his shoulder, every single viewer the world over felt the Fugitive's sense of urgency. David Jensen held us all together. As Richard Kimball, he became a symbol that inspired us to continue hoping and persisting, even when we were at our lowest ebb. What follows is a long overdue history devoted to this timeless classic. We'll meet many of the key people who put together the show we've continued to love for 30 years, including Roy Huggins, who created The Fugitive, Stanford Whitmore, whose script for the pilot episode set the entire series in motion, and producers Alan Armour and George Eckstein, the two people who understood The Fugitive better than anyone else. We'll go behind the scenes and get some insight into Richard Kimball and Philip Gerard from Barry Morse, and from writers Don Brinkley and Philip Saltzman. And we'll take in some memories of The Fugitive's beloved star, David Jensen, from the people who knew him best, the guest stars, the production staff, and the members of the crew. So, let's get started, and together we'll recapture The Fugitive. Act One. The most repulsive concept in history. Dan, I have something that everybody hates. Brett Maverick, the silver-tongued gambler who dressed in black and ran at the first sign of trouble. Gerald Lloyd Cookie Cookson, the hair-combing, ultra-cool parking attendant with a lingo all of his own. Jim Rockford, the classic TV private eye once described as a curveball in a world of fastballs. And Richard Kimball, the fugitive. Each of these characters are permanently etched in the minds of TV lovers the world over. And each was the center of enormously successful programs that changed the face of television drama. And each was formed out of the mind of one innovative man, Roy Huggins. Roy Huggins, born in 1914, began his career as a novelist. His first book, The Double Take, published in 1946, introduced Stu Bailey, the private eye with an Ivy League look and a Doc Walloper's punch, whose adventures were first adapted to the screen in I Love Trouble, which Huggins scripted, then later to television in 77 Sunset Strip, which Huggins created and produced. After several successful years as a motion picture writer and director, Huggins moved into television in 1955. He immediately established a solid reputation for himself by producing a string of hit series for Warner Brothers. Cheyenne, Maverick, for which he won an Emmy in 1959, and 77 Sunset Strip. After leaving Warner's in 1960, Huggins received a lucrative offer from Columbia Pictures to produce feature films. But Huggins wanted to stay in television.
It was true then, as it is today, that creative people in Hollywood have the single-minded goal of getting out of television and into theatrical films, he explained. But there are exceptions, and I was one of them. I knew that in theatrical films I would never get the kind of freedom I wanted unless I was in charge of the studio. And at that time, the movies were in decline. Weekly attendance had fallen from 80 million in 1946 to about 20 million in 1960. Television had taken away the traditional mass audience from the major studios. I decided that the movies were going to continue to decline and that the real money was in television. Huggins turned down the offer from Columbia. I made a mistake about the movies, he chuckled, but I wanted to stay in television. I decided that I wanted to develop a series, sell it, and finish my PhD work at UCLA, where I'd studied as an undergraduate.
I then sat down at home and started thinking. I wanted to create a contemporary series that would contain the elements that make Westerns so appealing. The shows I'd been working on from the time I came into television were Westerns, starting with Cheyenne and moving on to Maverick. Although I was tired of producing Westerns, I loved the freedom of the Western hero. I wanted to transfer that total freedom of the Western protagonist, who could wander from place to place, do anything he wanted, have a relationship with a woman, and then move on. I wanted to transfer that freedom to a character in a contemporary setting. And at first I thought it couldn't be done. I mean, if you put a man like that in a contemporary environment, he'll look like a bum, and the audience wouldn't accept him. In fact, they'd hate him. But then the answer hit me. He has to be a fugitive from injustice. He must have been accused of a crime, and it must be a capital crime, and he must have exhausted all of his appeals, so that he is truly a fugitive. And if they catch him, he dies. That's the only way I could have put the classic Western hero into a modern setting. The man cannot stay in one place because he is a fugitive, and so he must move on, and so forth.
It is widely assumed Huggins based The Fugitive on Les Miserables, Victor Hugo's epic novel of 1862 about a thief who tries to escape his criminal past and the determined police officer who refuses to let him. But that isn't the case.
I did mention Les Miserables in my presentation to ABC, but that wasn't really what triggered the idea, said Roy Huggins. The only source I drew from was the Western. I then wrote the concept of The Fugitive in 2 hours, including the signature, the opening scene, that introduces Richard Kimball and states his predicament. I then put those pages, 3 in number, away and went to bed. But I was so wound up over this idea, I just couldn't sleep. The following morning, I reread those pages very carefully, the way I always approach ideas when I write in a half dream at 3 o'clock in the morning. And by the time I was finished, I was convinced that I'd written a concept that was worth a fortune and was a work of genius. But it turned out to be the most repulsive concept in the history of man. Shortly after writing the treatment of The Fugitive, I signed a contract which put me in charge of television at 20th Century Fox. And I thought my contract was so good that I would give them The Fugitive. In effect, I would be making it a gift to 20th Century Fox, but also it would make me a very successful head of production, and I'd be getting a percentage of the profits and all the rest of it. After signing the Fox deal, I got on an airplane to come home, and seated next to me was my boss, Peter Levathis, president of Fox Television. We got to talking about what we were going to do, and I said, well, I've got the first show. It's called The Fugitive. And I told him precisely what The Fugitive was. Peter Levathis looked at me, and I could read his mind. And it turned out this is exactly what he was thinking. My God, what kind of horrendous mistake have we made? He didn't even comment. He instantly dropped it, and he said, let me tell you about an idea I have called Jules Verne. And he went on to talk about doing a series about Jules Verne stories. Then when we got to Los Angeles, Levathis had a private meeting with Fox executive Bill Self, and he told Self the conclusion that he'd drawn about me. I was put into a strange little office, and I called my lawyer, and I said, look, I think I've made a huge mistake. I told Mr. Lavathis a serious idea that I have, and I think he wants to get me out of here. So why don't you get me out first? Let us strike first. Well, my lawyer talked me out of it. He said, Roy, this'll pass. It's only one show. You have this great reputation, which you'll hurt if you quit at this early stage. And he gave me quite a pitch. So I said, well, look, I'll reserve my decision about dropping this job for a little longer. And by the way, I told my lawyer about the fugitive, and he also fell silent.
Despite Lavathy's reaction, Huggins continued to believe in the potential appeal of his idea. If you go back into the 40s and late 30s, you find film after film after film in which the story is about the protagonist who has been falsely accused, and he must prove that he is innocent, he said. That was so common that I felt it was appropriate to call that the American theme. What Huggins calls the American theme is an offshoot of the era of film noir, movies with a gritty urban setting that often depicted such scenes as guilt and salvation. The heroes of such pictures, including I'm a Fugitive from a Chain Gang, The Big Clock, Stranger on the Third Floor, and The Wrong Man, were often insecure loners who were tied to the past and unsure about the future. These films also had a permeating effect on television in the 50s and 60s, particularly as urban detective series such as M Squad, Naked City, and Quinn Martin's The Untouchables became increasingly popular. It had been proved time and time again that American audiences respond to that theme, said Huggins. After I thought of the idea, I said to myself, this is the American theme. This can't possibly fail.
Roy Huggins sought out everyone in television whose opinion he respected. Writers, directors, producers, friends, and told them about The Fugitive. Everyone he consulted found the idea absolutely repulsive. Some of them, he said, reacted in an embarrassed way. My agent actually looked ill, as if he might be thinking, hey, I gotta drop this guy. I remember I told it to Howard Brown, Scotch on the Rocks, one of my closest writer friends, and Howard looked at me and he said, Roy, you have a great reputation in television, and if you want to keep it, don't tell that idea to any of the networks. Well, Brown apparently changed his mind about The Fugitive later on, because he wrote a fourth season episode called A Clean and Quiet Town. By this time, even Huggins was convinced that The Fugitive was a terrible idea. If enough people tell you you're blind, you better go get yourself a dog, he said. So I put The Fugitive on the shelf and decided that Lavathis was right, and that I'd have to try to win my way back into his confidence, which I'd totally lost by telling him The Fugitive.
Although he continued to help Lavathis develop shows for 20th Century Fox, Huggins never regained the studio's confidence. The two men had disparate ideas on what would make a good series. I fought every one of their ideas, and all of them failed, Huggins said. Fox eventually relieved Huggins of his duties in early 1962. Lavathis was fired a short time later. In fact, the entire television department at Fox soon shut down. A little sour on the business, Huggins decided to drop out of television and pursue something that he had put off for too many years.
I had a brother who was a professor at the University of Arizona, and he lived a very happy life, said Roy Huggins. And that was the life I wanted, and that was the life I'd planned. I'd done 2 years of graduate work in political philosophy when I got shuttled off doing government work during World War II, but I'd always planned to go back and finish. But I was doing so well in television, I kept putting off what I'd always planned to do. But when Fox simply went belly up as a result of both its motion pictures and its television policies, I asked to be accepted into the graduate school at UCLA, which was not an easy thing to accomplish. In order to take me, somebody else had to be bumped.
Shortly after he was accepted at UCLA, Huggins was contacted by Dan Melnick, ABC's vice president of program development. Leonard Goldenson, the president of the network, wanted a meeting with Huggins. ABC was in serious trouble. They were in ratings trouble, and Goldenson was trying to save the network, Huggins recalled.
So he called Dan Melnick and said, here's a list of people, and I want to see each one of them. Well, Melnick called me and told me that Leonard Goldenson wanted to meet me. I told Dan that there was no point in that because I'd left television. I was trying to get my PhD, and I'd probably then go into academic work, and that I had no more interest in television. As much as I liked Leonard Goldenson, which I did, he's a very decent man, I discovered that Melnick was absolutely petrified. He put it this way to me. He said, Roy, I can't go to Leonard Goldenson and tell him you won't meet with him. And since he put it that way, and since I liked him, we'd worked together earlier in television, I said, well, look, Dan, I have something in a drawer that everybody hates, and I do mean they hate it. I mean, they find it distasteful. Just don't not like it. They're offended by it. But it's an idea called The Fugitive, and if you want me to meet with Leonard Goldenson, I will, and I'll tell him about The Fugitive.
Huggins met with Goldenson and several other prominent ABC executives, including Thomas Moore, the network's head of programming.
Well, I started to tell the concept of The Fugitive. And in the middle of it, Tom Moore got up and left the room, Huggins remembers. Other people were drumming on the arms of their chairs or swinging their feet or looking at their watches. It wasn't very easy for me to continue. Well, 2 minutes later, Tom Moore came out of the other room carrying a suitcase. And he went to the door and he said, Roy, I'm sorry, I've got to catch a plane. He made it very clear that he'd heard enough of this piece of you-know-what. Well, I finished the presentation, and then there was this dreadful silence. Leonard was just waiting for people to speak up. And, of course, nobody was going to speak up until Leonard spoke. Roy Huggins went on. And Leonard looked at me, and he said, Roy, that is the best idea for a television series that I've ever heard. And I thought, my God, I wasn't wrong after all. Leonard was the first man that heard my idea and actually liked it. Leonard understood it. Before he came to ABC, he ran Paramount Pictures, one of the studios that had made all those films about men falsely accused.
Goldenson liked the idea because it was different from anything on television at the time. I felt that it was distinctive and that the novelty of it would catch on, Goldenson recalled. Fortunately, it did. But Goldenson was surprised to learn that Huggins was not available to produce The Fugitive. Apparently no one told him that Huggins had already enrolled at UCLA, probably because nobody expected the series to be approved.
Leonard was absolutely astonished, said Roy Huggins. No one had ever said to him, I'll set it up for you, but I won't be producing it. That was unheard of. So Leonard looked around at the other people and said, well, who would we like to have Roy set this up with? And they didn't have any idea. Well, Roy Huggins suggested Quinn Martin. I knew that Quinn was a very efficient producer. I mean, he'd done some very successful shows, like The Untouchables. And I wanted the show to be a success, said Huggins. So I mentioned several names, and they accepted two of them. But the first one I met with was Quinn Martin.
After selling ABC the television rights to The Fugitive, Huggins and Martin worked out a deal. QM Productions would produce the series while Huggins would receive credit for creating it. Huggins maintained ownership of all other rights to The Fugitive. If Martin wasn't aware of all the problems he inherited, Huggins quickly filled in the details, such as the programming executive who had the temerity to denounce The Fugitive moments after Goldenson had okayed the series.
Julius Barnathan stood up after Goldenson had voiced his approval and said, well, I hate it, Huggins remembers. He made a speech about how un-American it was, how it was a slap in the face of American justice week after week, and he thought it was awful. Now, he's a very brave man because he'd heard his boss just declaring that it was the best idea he'd ever heard.
But Huggins knew that Martin faced a more formidable opponent in Thomas Moore, whose dissent was voiced in a manner far more telling than Barnathan's diatribe.
Tom Moore hated it so much he walked out. And I said to myself, he's going to give whoever does this show nothing but trouble.
Martin had already worked his way into the good graces of both Moore and ABC by virtue of producing The Untouchables, 1959-63. But Huggins knew that enough infighting over the fugitive existed to warrant concern, so he remained on board long enough to help Martin get the new series off the ground. Martin, born Martin Cohen in 1922, grew up in the motion picture industry. His father, Leonard, was a film editor. After graduating as an English major from the University of California, Berkeley, Martin himself started off as an editor at Universal Pictures, then gradually worked his way into television as a scriptwriter for many series. I had known Quinn when we were both at Ziv Studios, said Sutton Raleigh, who directed many of Martin's programs. I came out from New York, and Quinn was at Ziv in the sound department. He was married to Madeline Pugh at the time, who, along with Bob Carroll, was one of the major writers on I Love Lucy. Then Quinn left Ziv and became a writer-producer on such anthology shows as the Jane Wyman Theater. Then Madeline Pugh had something to do with him being brought into Desilu Productions, where he worked as a writer-producer on Desilu Playhouse. One of the shows he did for Desilu was a special called The Untouchables. It pulls such great numbers and a voluminous number of letters from the public. Because of the great response, another network, ABC, decided to make it into a series, and Quinn was made the producers. The Untouchables was the real start of Quinn Martin that really put him in the foreground of television producers as far as the networks were concerned. He did a great job on it. Based on the memoirs of government agent Elliot Ness, The Untouchables was an excitingly written and well-produced excursion into the Chicago crime wars of the Prohibition era. Although criticized on two fronts, one, the censors thought it was too violent, and two, many Italian-American groups were upset over its portrayal of Italians as gangsters, The Untouchables became one of ABC's first successful series. The rat-a-tat-tat narration of newspaper columnist Walter Wenchel helped give the series a newsreel documentary-type style that Martin would finally hone in many of his subsequent programs. After its second season, 1960-61, with The Untouchables ranked as the eighth most popular program on television, Martin left to start his own company, QM Productions. His first series as an independent producer was The New Breed, ABC, 1961-62.
People compare me to the old moguls of the movies, Martin told Robert Alley and Horace Newcomb in The Producer's Medium, Conversations with the Creators of American TV. I really am a controller, said Quinn Martin. I believe in control. When I say I'm a benevolent dictator, I really mean that. I was always brought up that the guy at the top had the responsibility of control, and that's an offshoot of my environment. I grew up in Hollywood, and I grew up seeing strong father figure images. Louis B. Mayer, Harry Cohn, Jack Warner, Adolf Zukor. And so I patterned my style without even thinking about it. I don't mean to sound like a braggart when I say control. I was given total control by a network which was looking desperately to get on the boards, and I pulled it off. I was the only one who did in those days. I had 3 shows in the top 10 for ABC, The Untouchables, The Fugitive, and The FBI, at a time when it was really tough, because we used to start off with 50 stations short the first of every year and have to prove ourselves, be tougher than anybody. I earned my stripes in a very tough market.
Martin was one of the first producers who really exploited the visual possibilities of television, according to scholar David Thornburn. He was very conscious of the extent to which black and white photography, that sort of shadowed effect that was created by these dark streets in both The Untouchables and The Fugitive, was an explicit echo of film noir, said Thornburn, who interviewed Martin in 1978 for his forthcoming book on television. He saw The Fugitive as a show that tried to recapture some of the ambience of film noir. He was conscious of the extent to which television was a modified, small in form of the movies. He tried to have The Untouchables edited in a movie-like way, with more cuts than were usual on television and with fewer fade-outs. He was also conscious of the camera angle as a strategy that can compensate for the fact that vast panoramas don't work well on television. There are a number of almost artsy shots in The Untouchables that consciously aim for effects that are appropriate to the small screen. Shots through windows are shots in which the camera will gaze through the legs of a chair, which then frames a face in the background. Martin knew he had introduced a movie-like quality to television film production with The Untouchables.
The motion picture quality was not the only distinguishing feature of Quinn Martin's programs. For nearly 20 years, TV viewers could recognize a Martin series by the superimposed Act 1, Act 2, Act 3, Act 4, and epilogue that began each segment of every episode. While these affectations certainly catered to Martin's eccentricities, they also underscored his keen understanding of the medium. According to television scholar David Thorburn, Quinn Martin believed it was important to differentiate between the television program and the commercials that sponsored it. The format that would become his signature was Martin's way of acknowledging the commercial interruptions without sacrificing any of the dramatic integrity of his programs. Martin wanted a clear signal to the audience that we are coming to a break now, said David Thorburn. One of the most important contributions Martin made to television was his sense that television was a segmented form. The commercial environment of television required that you create mini-dramas that come to a kind of mini-climax just before the commercial and have sharp, clear demarcations identifying themselves as separate segments. In other words, it was his way of trying to keep the commercial interruptions from contaminating his programs.
Martin divided dramatic television into three components: melodrama, or plot and action, theme, or social relevance, and emotion, the human element. Martin believed that the emotional component was the most important of the three because it was the one element that best reflected his dramatic ideals, his intention of presenting things as they should be. An emotional content governed the ratio between melodrama and theme. For Martin, emotion was what made a program honest. It cut across all socioeconomic lines and affected people on a fundamentally human level. In his view, a program with a proper emotional balance was a program that would appeal to the mass general audience across the country. If things are emotionally correct, then you hit everybody, Martin told the producer's medium. I always try to make sure that the characters are motivated properly, that people get a feeling of what's going on. I've always been rather proud that my shows really hit a very broad section. I get the college kids, and I get the truck drivers. You can't hate anybody named Lincoln. Martin completely understood Huggins' concept and knew how he could exploit it. But he first needed a story for the pilot, the test film designed to launch the series. Huggins' three-page screenplay provided him with the basic premise. Richard Kimball was innocent. He had seen a gaunt, red-haired man fleeing from his home. He was convicted of his wife's murder on circumstantial evidence, and he escaped the death house as a result of a train wreck. The pilot had to, one, convince the network's remaining skeptics that the fugitive was worthy of investment, two, resolve any ethical conflicts surrounding Kimball's fugitive status, and, three, elicit sympathy from the viewing public and potential sponsors. To write the pilot, Martin summoned Stanford Whitmore, the talented screenwriter who was the script editor on The New Breed, which ABC had just canceled.
I went in to see Quinn, and he handed me three pages and said, "Sit down on the couch and read these, and tell me what you think," recalled Whitmore, one-time novelist who had already made the successful transition to film and television writing. If I remember right, the first sequence was written in screenplay form, Now, that was the train wreck, Whitmore continues. And then Roy wrote, "And thus begins an exciting new series called The Fugitive." And then he went into a couple of pages of philosophizing about the appeal of such a show. He brought up as an illustration Shane, film about the mysterious drifter who came into town and set everything right and then moved on. And so I said to Quinn, "Okay, sure, yes, I think I could have fun with this thing."
In order to hit the mass general audience, the pilot needed two key ingredients. The first was a matter of approach. Martin felt the essence of The Fugitive was that this upper-middle-class figure and a doctor was forced to go underground and become part of the working class, according to David Thornburn. The interest of the series would reside in the fact that this professional figure was forced to take on a series of menial jobs: bartender, ditch digger, apprentice carpenter, etc. Martin believed the audience would identify with those experiences. In most television programs, even if the guy has a job, you don't remember it after the series went off the air, added Stephen King. But I remember a lot of different jobs that Richard Kemble had. I could believe him chopping cabbages down there in Texas or Louisiana, and I could believe him parking cars in Michigan. It was the only show on television where it even sort of hinted that there was a job somewhere besides being a cop or a cowboy at the time. This guy did everything. They were real jobs, real backgrounds. In most TV shows, even if the main character had a job, you know what it is, they never have to do it. You know, Ben Cartwright and his boys, Bonanza, had a ranch, but they never had to run it. It apparently ran itself. All they did was sit around the table, and Hop Singh would bring them coffee, and they'd drink it. Or a truer example was Dr. Kildare, who had the time to solve everybody's problems.
The second and most important key ingredient of the pilot was creating a decent protagonist. After Martin told him of the network's apprehensions about The Fugitive, Whitmore knew how he wanted to proceed. Some people back there felt that the sponsors would not want to be identified with someone who was running from the law, he said. But Quinn and I pointed out to them that the guy was innocent. But, of course, with their wonderful logic, they said that didn't make any difference. ABC was nervous that sponsors might shy away from even being associated with a fugitive, because the word fugitive had a bad connotation. So I said to Quinn, "I'll fix this guy up good, and no sponsor will want to run from him." And in the pilot episode, I gave him the alias Jim Lincoln. And I said to Quinn, "Okay, now you can't hate anybody called Lincoln."
With his aim at the collective heartstrings of the American television audience, Whitmore employed several other devices calculated to garner sympathy for the fugitive Kimball.
I thought what Kimball should do for the overall story is rescue someone, preferably a woman, for the romantic aspect, and for the bittersweet quality of having to move on, he continued. I think Vera Miles played it. She was a cocktail pianist in a bar in Tucson, Arizona, and Kimball was a bartender, and she had a husband, played by Brian Keith, who was very powerful but somewhat demented, and he was sort of sadistically harassing his wife. And then the second shamelessly calculated piece of business was that she had a son, and Kimball, alias Lincoln, was going to save her, and he was also going to befriend her son. He was going to do something nice. We were going to have a scene with the kid. Well, Quinn Martin liked where the story was headed, so he left me alone to finish the first draft. And I discovered at the end that I still had another trick up my sleeve in the way of shameless calculation, Whitmore continued. The pilot really ends in a nice black-and-white situation. There's this railroad yard, and Kimball is leaving town after having fixed everything, when, lo and behold, there's a stray kitten that he encounters, and he picks up the kitten. He would, of course, like to take the kitten with him, but he can't because he's a fugitive.
and he must go on. Well, if you don't like Richard Kimball after that...
Whitmore completed the first draft. Martin then forwarded the script to Callum DeForest, a researcher for ABC's Errors and Omissions Division who reviewed scripts for any potentially liable material. DeForest noticed a remarkable similarity between Dr. Kimball's red-haired stranger and a prominent character in a well-publicized news story. Kellum called Quinn, Whitmore recalled, and he said, "My God, this red-haired man, Huggins stole it from the Sam Shepard case." Samuel Shepard, an osteopath from Cleveland, Ohio, was convicted of bludgeoning his wife to death in 1954. Shepard claimed that the real perpetrator was a bushy-haired stranger who he saw running around the neighborhood. The story made headlines all over the nation and eventually provided the basis for a 1975 made-for-TV movie, Guilty or Innocent, the Sam Shepard murder case, starring George Peppard as Dr. Shepard. The case was in its eighth year of appeal by the time The Fugitive premiered in 1963. Interestingly enough, the Supreme Court dismissed Shepard's conviction during the program's third season, 1965-66. In so ruling, the court stated that the virulent publicity surrounding The Fugitive, at that time the fifth highest rated show on television, had sufficiently obscured the facts of the Shepard case.
Shortly after the show began, I received a letter from a lady in Boston who asked me where I got the idea for The Fugitive, Roy Huggins recalls. I was a little suspicious because I knew that Sam Shepard's lawyer, F. Lee Bailey, had his offices in Boston. And after I wrote the woman back, I found out that she was indeed Bailey's secretary. Well, she needn't have bothered writing because I wasn't at all influenced by the Sam Shepard case. But nevertheless, the parallel was too coincidental. So Martin and Whitmore went back to the drawing board. We sat around Quinn's office and we said, well, now, what are we going to do about this? Who is going to be the villain of the piece? What distinctive quality is this guy going to have? Whitmore said. And I remembered that when I was a kid, what always scared me about horror movies was they always had someone with a club foot or something dragging his leg. It was really kind of old-fashioned melodramatic horror, but it always worked on me. And then I said, no, scratch that, because he's got to be some kind of a worthy adversary for Richard Kimball at some point. And after all, if the guy's handicapped and simply can't move about, well, no. And then we talked. I said, hey, what about one arm? Maybe the guy's missing an arm. And Quinn said, that's it. That's terrific. Then we spent about 20 minutes trying to decide whether it should be the right arm or the left arm. I know I suggested it should be the right arm because most people are right-handed and consequently their right hand wouldn't get them into trouble. And so there was born the idea of the one-armed man.
But then another small glitch was discovered. Our original pilot script was supposed to be set in the state of Wisconsin, noted Barry Morse. After the series was launched, some citizen, whether within our organization or outside it, I don't know, pointed out that the whole premise of The Fugitive would fall to the ground, punctured, if the location were set in Wisconsin, because at the time, there was no capital punishment in the state of Wisconsin. So, arbitrarily, the locale of the series was shifted to Indiana.
Whitmore corroborates this story. I distinctly remember writing in the pilot that Kimball said he was from Wisconsin, he said. Why they changed it to Indiana, I've no idea. But if it was changed for that reason, undoubtedly, Kellum, who never missed anything, would have come up with it and discovered something like that and then say, hey, now, wait a minute, we've got to change it to a state that has capital punishment. Well, 2 years after The Fugitive premiered, Indiana also repealed the death penalty. Well, with these details straightened out, Quinn Martin then sent a copy of the script to Roy Huggins, who had remained in the background up to this point, and after reviewing Whitmore's revised script, Huggins addressed two elements which he thought needed changing. He first objected to the idea of having Dr. Kimball maintain the same alias for the entire series. I found that out by accident, Huggins recalled. I was reading the pilot script, and his name in that script was Jim Lincoln. At some point, I then asked Quinn, of course, his name isn't going to be Jim Lincoln next week, is it? Oh, sure, said Quinn, that's his name. That's the name he's going to use. Can't have him having a different name every week. It'll confuse the audience. But I said, hey, now wait a minute. This guy's a fugitive. When he moves on for a reason. He's not going to take the same name with him. I also discovered that Quinn was going to have the man keeping a diary. On the old theory in this town that all protagonists have to have someone to talk to, said Roy Huggins. I mean, when I took over Cheyenne, the character had a comic partner. And I said, no, we've got to get rid of the comic partner. And they said, well, whom will he have to talk to? And I said, well, you find that they always have somebody to talk to in B pictures. In A pictures, they don't have anybody to talk to. The scenes are dramatized. They aren't talked about. And so I won that point. Well, again, now here it was, God knows how much later, and I was getting the same answers. Well, you've got to keep a diary because he hasn't got anybody to talk to. And I said, now, wait a minute. He's carrying a diary in his pocket that says, I am a fugitive from a murder conviction. Well, in your pilot, he's arrested. They'll find the diary. No, he doesn't need a diary. He doesn't need someone to talk to. So he doesn't need a diary. So, finally, the diary was thrown out. It wasn't difficult for me to persuade Quinn Martin that a mistake was being made, Huggins remembers. Otherwise, I was quite pleased with the pilot. I thought that the script was well conceived, and with those two things out of the way, I felt certain that the project was off to a good start.
Martin and Whitmore then met with the ABC brass to discuss the next step, casting. According to Hollywood legend, over 50 actors interviewed for the lead role, including such prominent names as James Franciscus, Anthony Franciosa, and Robert Lansing. But according to Stanford Whitmore, this is one instance where legend had it all wrong. I've met an awful lot of actors in this town who claimed they turned down The Fugitive, and I just smile at all that, he said. Because Quinn Martin had no one else in mind but David Janssen. He wanted him from the beginning, and that was that. Martin had kept his eye on Janssen ever since their days at Universal Pictures in the 1950s. Martin was a film editor, Janssen a contract player. I saw a lot of him back then, Martin told Newsweek in 1965. He struck me as a person that would never fade into the woodwork. A fine athlete during his years at Fairfax High School in Hollywood, Janssen, born David Harold Meyer in 1931, twisted his knee during a pole vaulting exhibition, an injury that would dog him for the rest of his life. His mother, Bernice, a former Ziegfeld showgirl and one-time Miss Universe runner-up, encouraged him to take up acting. At age 18, he landed a contract with 20th Century Fox Studios, where well-meaning producers, aghast at the size of his large ears, used rubber cement to pin them back. That didn't work. The ears lay too flat. The producers then wanted his ears fixed surgically, but Janssen objected to that. Fox also wanted to alter Janssen's hairline, but when the producers couldn't do anything about that, they let him go. Janssen then moved on to Universal International and appeared in 32 pictures where he played, as he put it, the agreeer. The star would approach me and ask, don't you think so, Harry? And I'd agree and disappear. Janssen told TV Guide in 1965, but he soon caught the eye of TV producer and one-time movie star Dick Powell, who saw in Janssen a younger version of himself. Powell, who played Richard Diamond in Radio, cast Janssen as the private eye for the TV version. He was brash then, recalled Philip Saltzman. I was working at Four Star Productions, where David filmed Richard Diamond. I was a story editor on the Alcoa Goodyear Theater, which was also produced by Four Star, and David's office was right across the hall from my producers. David used to come into my office, and we'd sit around and talk, and he was always doing Cary Grant imitations, you know, turning his head and saying, "Judy, Judy." But Jansen struggled, at least in his own mind, after Richard Diamond was canceled. Despite the steady diet of television work, he wanted to succeed in movies, a goal that would never materialize.
The thing that I remember about David was that I don't think he knew how good he was, said Whitmore. When The Fugitive was riding high, television was still the stepchild. The really important stuff was in features. And although David was in features, he never became the great movie star, the Robert Redford sort of thing. And I think that always nagged him a little. And that was too bad, because he was a terrific personality and a hard-working and reliable artist. He was a real professional. But I think he undervalued himself. Roy Huggins thought Jansen was an excellent choice. "I'd used him on other shows and thought very highly of him," he said. "David was a good friend of mine. We used to play poker together. I don't remember at what point his name came up. It may have been brought up by Quinn Martin. But yes, he became the only one that I could even see as the fugitive."
In lieu of a salary, Jansen negotiated a deal in which he would receive 10% of the series' profits. "David was not only a wonderful person, he was a very smart guy," said Whitmore. "I think he understood better than I did the possibilities of this. By the time The Fugitive left the air in 1967, Jansen had earned over $4.5 million. However, as line producer Alan Armour points out, Martin had to deal with one small detail before Jansen could shoot the pilot. David had a commitment with somebody, recalled Armour, who produced the first three seasons of the series. Somebody had optioned him for a series, and in order for David to be able to do the pilot, Quinn put up some of his own money to buy him out of whatever that other contract was. And obviously, that was a good investment. After meeting and discussing the script with Jansen, Whitmore began working on the second draft, while Martin sought his only choice to play Lieutenant Philip Gerard, the character he once described as the sen quanon of the series. Barry Morse once estimated that he's played over 2,000 parts on stage, screen, radio, and television over the course of his 60-year career. "I've never performed on the high wire, on ice, or underwater, but I'm ready if need be," he once joked. Born in London, England in 1918, he won, at age 15, the principal scholarship at the Royal Academy of Dramatic Art, the youngest person admitted to the Academy at that time. In his final term, he won the BBC Award and the title role in Henry V. He then played in a number of repertory companies and theaters throughout England, as well as London's West End. He also worked as a director, then began acting on BBC Radio in 1936. He appeared in many BBC television shows beginning in 1937, and then later branched into films. His first was The Goose Steps Out in 1940. He married actress Sidney Sturgis in 1939. Their daughter Melanie was born in 1945. Their son Hayward in 1947. The Morse family moved to Canada in 1951, where he appeared in countless films and TV and radio productions for the CBC. He's worked as an actor, director, and writer all over the world, from Austria to New Zealand.
By the time we began The Fugitive, I'd worked intermittently in the U.S. over a period of 5 or 6 years. This is me now, Barry Morse, talking about myself. My wife and I had not ever set up actual residence in the U.S. We still had a home in Toronto, in Canada. But from around 1957 or 58, I'd been commuting both to New York and to L.A. to do individual shows, things like the U.S. Steel Hour, Studio One, Twilight Zone, Naked City, dozens of the popular shows of that time. Well, among other shows, I'd played in several episodes of The Untouchables. Quinn Martin, our producer, was a man of quite uncommon good sense and good taste and general decency, which was by no means universally the case among Hollywood producers. and I came to know him and to like him. And one fine day when I was in Hollywood, Quinn rang me up and he said, look, I'm planning a new series, and there's a character in it that I'd like you to play. It's not exactly a running character, sort of a recurring character, in that it won't be in every episode. And he said, look, I don't want to tell you any more about it, but I'll send you around the script, and then let's have lunch. So the script arrived, which was all about a man falsely accused of the murder of his wife and his pursuit by a dedicated officer of the law. Well, the character of the man on the run was a decent, admirable sort of character, and quite unmistakably Middle America. And the law officer was even more of a kind of archetypically Middle American character, conceived and written in the then quite conventional way of the raincoat and fedora kind of detective, well known in Hollywood. Now, to that point, I'd played all kinds of different American characters, even for Quinn on The Untouchables. I think I remember playing some kind of an East Side thug in one episode of The Untouchables. And I didn't realize that it was implicitly something of a compliment that producers and directors never hesitated to hire me to play all sorts of different kinds of American characters. And I was more than a little vain about my skill with accents and dialects. You see, while I was a student at the Royal Academy, I'd developed a sort of flexible inner ear, I suppose you'd call it, that enabled me to produce more or less accurately any kind of accent after I was exposed to it for a little while. In fact, I think that The Fugitive was the only instance up to that time when a British actor played an American character in a television series. At any rate, I thought that both those characters in the proposed pilot for The Fugitive were so down the middle, as it were, in terms of American characterization, that Quinn couldn't possibly want me to play the man on the run or the law officer. I thought the only solution must be that somebody in his office had sent me the wrong script. So when I met Quinn for lunch a couple of days later, I was all set to explain this to him when he launched into an enthusiastic description of the outline of this proposed series and made it quite clear that he actually wanted me to play the detective. Well, initially, I rather resisted the idea. I said, look, Quinn, this character, as I see it in this pilot script, is a thoroughly conventional rendering of a thoroughly conventional American detective, as seen in the movies. Ah, yes, that's the trouble, you see, said Quinn. Yes, I know that. The character, as presently expressed, is, well, too much on the nose. And he said, I know you're always interested in developing slightly offbeat characters. So why don't you think about it and see if you can't develop something that's a bit more unusual? Well, although I'd made several television pilots before, I'd never worked in quite that circumstance of developing a character. It was interesting, but also somewhat alarming to be faced with that much responsibility. But, of course, I recognized immediately that this script that we had, the skeletal elements of the Fugitive story, was a modern remake of Les Misérables. And I mentioned this to Quinn, and he said, well, yes, of course, that is true, although, of course, naturally we're not advertising it, but this is a sort of modern rendition of the outline of Les Misérables. Well, I've always thought that we in the arts, whichever art we happen to be in, we're all shoplifters. I mean, everybody, from Shakespeare onwards and downwards, who enters any of our activities, has to acknowledge that we are shoplifters. But once you've acknowledged that, I always say, make sure that when you set out on a shoplifting expedition, that you go always to Cartier's and never to Woolworths. So on that basis, and with that idea in mind, I thought that Victor Hugo wasn't a bad sort of role model, if we were going to have a role model for our author. So I went back to Les Misérables, and especially to the character of Javert, the police officer who becomes engrossed with the pursuit of the hero Jean Valjean. Now, this may seem to be a very highfalutin way of setting about what was, after all, a fairly commonplace exercise in Hollywood, making a television series pilot, but it seemed to me that we might as well go to the best places for our shoplifting, and that certainly more flesh could be put onto this character, something a bit less like the conventional Hollywood dick, so beloved and so much overplayed in so many movies. Because I wanted to develop over a period of time a rather more complex and less usual sort of character for this detective who was to be the nemesis, as it were, of our hero. It's somewhat interesting, by the way, that that faintly French ring to the name Gerard, there may even have been some subconscious echoes of Les Misérables in the choice of that name. Well, according to Stanford Whitmore, it was more than a subconscious echo. It was a quite deliberate take. I gave Lieutenant Gerard the name Gerard because I was having a little fun, said Whitmore. I wanted to see if anybody might recognize that the name Gerard was very close to the name Javert.
With Moore set to play Gerard, Martin then hired prominent director Walter Grauman and Vera Miles and Brian Keith as the marquee guest stars. In February 1963, the cast and crew traveled to Tucson, Arizona to film Fear in a Desert City, the pilot episode. Shooting the pilot was easy. Convincing the skeptics at ABC that the fugitive was a winner was an entirely different matter. Act Two, the pilot, Fear in a Desert City. Fate moves its huge hand. At the heart of the fugitive is the preoccupation with guilt and salvation, which has been called the American theme, wrote Roy Huggins in his 1960 network presentation of the fugitive. Kimball is pursued, and in the eyes of the law, he is guilty. But no American of any persuasion will find him so. The idea of natural law is too deeply embedded in the American spirit for anyone to question Kimball's right after all recourse to law has been exhausted to preserve his own life. Even Hobbes, the great philosopher of authoritarianism, acknowledged one circumstance in which a man has a right to resist Leviathan, when an attempt is made to take his life on mistaken grounds. Some 6 months stood between the completion of the pilot episode in early March 1963 and the fugitive's scheduled premiere in September. In addition to the usual headaches associated with producing a television series, Quinn Martin had to contend with the dissension at ABC over the fugitive. Despite network president Leonard Goldenson's support, the likes of programming head Thomas Moore continued to grumble about the new series. Martin was also beginning to experience some of the same problems Huggins went through. His closest friends had their doubts about the fugitive. I had known Quinn Martin from the days when he was a sound editor at the old Ziv Studios, said writer-producer Don Brinkley. We were old friends. I'd done a number of his other shows, The Untouchables, The New Breed, The Jane Wyman Theater. When he was telling me about the fugitive and showed me the pilot, I said, well, it's a great idea, but what do you do for your 14th show? You're going to run out of ideas in about 13 shows. Quinn said, well, I'll take the chance. And that's how much I know. Brinkley, who would contribute 5 scripts to The Fugitive, certainly had a point. Many series before and since The Fugitive have failed because they could not sustain the premise, no matter how innovative, for the entire length of a television season. In 1963, a full season ranged from 30 to 39 episodes. ABC wondered what direction The Fugitive would take after the pilot, what kind of stories we would be telling, said Stanford Whitmore. So Quinn and I sat down, and in the space of about 20 minutes came up with 10 stories, very quickly, very easily. That was a lot of fun because we didn't have to resolve them. They were really just kind of premises. I remember one time that Quinn liked fights, boxing, and so did I. And I said, look, this guy's a doctor. Suppose he gets a job as a cut man for a prize fighter. Quinn said, great. That's the story which led to the episode Decision in the Ring. We really thought them up rapidly. Then Quinn sent off that list to propose stories to ABC, and that apparently comforted them, where they could see where we'd be going after the pilot show. what kind of situations we'd be getting involved with. Martin then recognized something else about Huggins' concept that the network had overlooked. The Fugitive was based on the premise that was completely elastic. The pilot episode demonstrated that the actual search for Kemble was a secondary, albeit important, element of the overall story. The true drama, and ultimately what made The Fugitive so appealing, was the moral dilemma that Kemble confronted each week, i.e. he had to resolve the conflict facing the people he became involved with that week without endangering his own life. Since he had to leave town at the end of each episode, Kemble could land anywhere, in any job, and the story would still make sense. The Fugitive was an anthology show with a running character. That was the big advantage of it, said director Sutton Raleigh. Most series have running characters, like cops or lawyers or doctors or whatever, and those characters do the same job each and every week, whereas David Janssen and The Fugitive could be thrown into an entirely different type of situation each week. It was always moving and had people in it, but it was primarily a character show. It dealt with people. In the tradition of the many dramatic anthology programs that populated television throughout the 1950s and 60s, many episodes of The Fugitive consisted of small character studies of the various people and towns Kemble encountered during his search for the one-armed man. Kemble and the basic fugitive concept served as a skeleton around which the scripts were wrapped. ABC president Leonard Goldenson thought it was a great approach. I felt that it was certainly an exciting way to be telling a story about an innocent person trying to prove that he was innocent, he said. The elasticity of the premise gave The Fugitive the sort of forward motion characteristic of another narrative genre, the novel. I got the sense that the writers on The Fugitive were telling one whole story, observed Stephen King. The concept itself was a novelistic concept. You had a main character who had a potentially life-threatening or life-ending problem, as opposed to Ward Bond and Wagon Train, who simply had to keep wagon training, and then people came on and he solved their problems. If you imagine a group therapy session of popular TV characters, with people sitting in chairs around the circle, most of the characters, guys like the Wagon Master, or Gil Favor and Rawhide, or possibly George Maharis and Martin Milner and Route 66, would never raise their hands. But if you raised your hand, they would be able to solve your problems. Then you have this other very small group of characters, like Paul Bryan from Run for Your Life, Harlan from The Golden Years, or Richard Kemble. These characters are constantly raising their hands. Harlan saying, I have a problem because I was involved with an accident. I'm an old man who's growing younger and everybody's hunting for me. And then Kemble raises his hand and says, they want to kill me in the death house. They think I killed my wife and I have to find the man. Have you seen this man? I have a problem and I need to find this man. So there's a novelistic situation. The only thing about The Fugitive that doesn't happen in a novel, because the series ran for 4 years, is that the problem remains static. I'm looking for the one-armed man, and this guy pops up in different places, King continued. But the concept is still more realistic than the standard situation on something like Murder, She Wrote, or Perry Mason, where week after week these things happen to other people. With a character like Richard Kemble, it's natural that things should happen to him, because he has to keep outrunning the police. The Fugitive also owes some of its success to the cliffhanger element of the old-time Saturday afternoon matinee adventures. When this pilot was produced, all the experts pronounced that it couldn't possibly succeed or even get on the air because it had no successful ending, recalled Barry Morse. Well, of course, they'd completely ignored the impact of the cinema serials of the 1930s and 40s. And to go a little further back, that of the literary serials of the 19th century. In both of these cases, the very absence of an ending in the ordinary sense of the word, so far from being a disadvantage, served as a powerful and an immense hook. The Fugitive also relies on the assumption that Although narrow escapes and lucky coincidences abound, the viewers will suspend their disbelief so long as the writing holds up and the characters remain appealing. If the audience is really involved, you can make that assumption. Martin told TV Guide in 1964, look at the Westerns. They do the same thing. Nobody really thinks the hero will be gunned down in the duel at high noon, but everyone watches as if he might. This explains why episodes like Nightmare at North Oak and The Endgame, two shows in which Gerard comes tantalizingly close to capturing Kimball, remain exciting to watch 30 years later. Even though we know that Kimball will escape, it's still fun to see just how he does it. The writing continues to convey the inherent tension of the series premise. You get that little frisson every time Kimball walks through a bus station past his own poster on the wall, added King. Although Martin was certain that television audiences would take to his new series, he still needed to convince ABC that The Fugitive would appeal to potential sponsors as well. While the network arranged for several advance showings of the pilot before its September premiere, Martin recruited Janssen and Morse to help promote the series.
I remember that among all the other opinions collected on the basis of this pilot, there was a huge split of reaction to the two characters of Kimball and Gerard. On the one hand, there was immense sympathy, immense warmth felt from people who recorded their impressions of the pilot episode. Support and sympathy towards the character of Richard Kimball, of course. And, of course, the natural counterpart was the response to Lieutenant Gerard. I remember that Quinn Martin was very much amused by this. I remember him saying to me, just before the show actually went on the air, he said, boy, all those people in the commercial world are very worried about you. And I said, well, what do you mean, worried about me? He said, well, it's this performance of yours, because they keep coming to me and saying, we've done all this audience testing, and they love David Janssen. But boy, oh boy, they hate that guy Morse. You've got to get him out of there. And Quinn would say, no, 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 that's the whole point. Because, of course, in the climate of those days, it was totally unheard of to have a serious character whom you were deliberately meant to dislike. Indeed, that was some 15 years before the era where American television audiences embraced such prominent villains as J.R. Ewing or Alexis Carrington. It was very rare, in fact, for an actor to want to play such a character. But, of course, as Quinn patiently pointed out to anyone who cared to listen, the more animosity, the more resistance there was to Lieutenant Gerard, by simple mathematical process, the more sympathy there would be created for Richard Kimball, for David Janssen. So that intensity of response was implicitly a great testimony to the strength of what we were delivering. Well, the response of the two characters is also a testimony to Stanford Whitmore's strength as a writer, because his script elicited just the sort of response which he and Quinn Martin had counted on. I personally don't think that actors half often enough acknowledge the importance of the quality of the writing. After all, it is, in any dramatic offering, the writing where the battle is won and lost. Anyway, Roy Huggins was also pleased with the pilot script. Stanford Whitmore did a very, very good job, he said. He and Quinn did exactly what they should have done to present Richard Kimball with great sympathy.
With network president Leonard Goldenson's faith in the program sustained, ABC ordered a full season, 30 episodes, and scheduled The Fugitive for Tuesday nights at 10 p.m. Fear in a Desert City aired September 17, 1963. Nearly 3 years to the day when the idea first took root in Huggins' mind, and having withstood every conceivable argument against its existence, Richard Kimball's quest for the one-armed man had finally begun. The early reviews were encouraging. The measure of The Fugitive is that a viewer has a hankering to stick around for another week and see how and under what circumstances David Janssen successfully eludes the law, noted the New York Times review on television, September 25, 1963. Quinn Martin's professional touch and its cast of eminently qualified stars gives this series promise. If you're looking for something different, You could do far worse than to try this ABC show, wrote Cleveland Amory, TV Guide, January 11th, 1964. It is not, as its title suggests, merely another gun run where the good guys get the bad guys in the end. Rather, it's an adult drama, excitingly and often excellently written, in which one good guy, who cannot turn to any authority to help him, has to get the bad guys before the end, because for him, literally, there is no end. Years later, Huggins recalls meeting with Goldenson long after The Fugitive became a huge success. Leonard said, "Did you ever have any trouble when you told that idea to people?" And I laughed and I said, "Why, Leonard?" And he said, "Because I had nothing but trouble. I got letters from the American Legion, from the Bar Association, from my own people, from my own people. Opposed me every inch of the way. I almost canceled the show. And you know, the funny thing is, Roy, once they went on the air, we didn't hear from any of those people." Huggins knows the reason why. "The American people never saw a thing wrong with it," he said. "That's the American theme, rooting for the underdog, and they recognized it. Here's an innocent man who's fighting for his life, against all odds, and the public was pulling for him to find that person," added Goldenson. "People like pulling for an innocent person."
Plot, synopsis, and backstory of Fear in a Desert City. We see a train heading into the night. An omniscient narrator introduces us to two of its passengers. Name, Richard Kimball. Profession, Doctor of Medicine. Destination, Death Row, State Prison. Richard Kimball has been tried and convicted for the murder of his wife. But laws are made by men, carried out by men, and men are imperfect. Richard Kimball is innocent. Proved guilty, what Richard Kimball could not prove was that moments before discovering his wife's body, he encountered a man running from the vicinity of his home, a man with one arm, a man he had never seen before, a man who has not yet been found. Richard Kimball ponders his fate as he looks at the world for the last time and sees only darkness. But in that darkness, fate moves its huge hand. The train derails, and in the confusion, Dr. Kimball makes his escape. In each subsequent episode of The Fugitive, an abbreviated version of the foregoing introduction restates the premise and reestablishes the mood of the series. Prologue. Now 6 months a fugitive, this is Richard Kimball with a new identity, and for as long as it's safe, a new name, James Lincoln. He thinks of the day when he might find the man with one arm. But now is now. And this is how it is with him. Another journey, another place. Walk neither too fast nor too slow. Beware the eyes of strangers. Keep moving. Kimball chooses a hotel. Is it the right one? Or will it be a mistake? Is this the trap where it will end? Safe. For now. Another room. Windows look out. Windows look in. Get busy. Kimball stares at his reflection in the mirror and applies black dye to his hair. Look closely. Be sure of this. They'll never stop looking. And he'll never stop. Not Lieutenant Gerard. Synopsis. In Tucson, Arizona, Dr. Kimball finds a job as a bartender at the Branding Iron Saloon, where he falls for the pianist, Monica Wells. Monica has been trying to shield herself and her son, Mark, from her husband, Edward Wells, a wealthy businessman who is insanely jealous. Wells quickly discovers Kimball's involvement with his family and influences two police detectives to run Kimball out of town. With no other choice, Kimball arranges to leave, but not before he sees Monica and tells her his secret. Extremely moved by the fugitive's plight, Monica decides that she and Mark will leave with Kimball and protect him from Gerard. However, an enraged Wells quickly determines Monica's plan and tries to head them off at the bus depot. Wells confronts Kimball just as he, Monica, and Mark are about to board a bus for San Diego. Epilogue. Now, 6 months, 2 weeks, and another 1,000 miles of fugitive. This is Richard Kimball, and this is how it is with him. One of the fugitive's most recognized characteristics, the distinctive voice of William Conrad as the narrator, provided a sense of direction, not only for Dr. Kimball, but for millions of television viewers across the globe. That was one of Quinn's little quirks. He liked the narrator, noted Stanford Whitmore, of the device which Quinn Martin had previously used on The Untouchables, the breathless delivery of syndicated newspaper columnist Walter Winchell. A lot of people say that a narrator is a crutch, and it can be a crutch, but it can also be terrifically effective. It can bridge scenes, time, almost subliminally make an audience feel the way you want them to feel. And it gives you an opportunity, as a writer, to write some good stuff that you can't put into the mouths of characters who are in a dramatic situation. The narrator can stand back and make these comments. William Conrad was an inspired choice as the narrator. He'd already narrated The Bullwinkle Show and had starred as Matt Dillon on the radio version of Gunsmoke. Conrad, with his booming delivery, still has one of the most recognized voices in the entertainment industry, rivaled perhaps only by that of James Earl Jones. When Whitmore discovered that Conrad would narrate The Fugitive, he deliberately scripted the narrator's speeches to cater to the actor's commanding voice. I wanted to give Bill the kind of words that he could really make sound important and ominous, such as the way he says in the beginning, "Fate moves its huge hand," Whitmore said. Usually limited to a few brief, sometimes terse remarks to open and close each episode, the role of the narrator is extended in this first episode. Here, the narrator is the guiding force for not only the fugitive, but for the story as well. As Kimball checks into the hotel, for example, the narrator becomes an extension of the fugitive's consciousness that allows us to hear exactly what Kimball is thinking. The right one, or will it be a mistake? Is this the trap where it will end? This is particularly important in that Kimball has no dialogue in his first scenes. His thoughts, his feelings, his emotions are communicated entirely through the narrator. And these first scenes with Kimball are tremendously well done. Moving perfectly in sync with Conrad's narrative, David Janssen pantomimes the fugitive's fear and paranoia. There's also a good quality in the way Janssen delivers his first lines. "My name is Jim Lincoln." He conveys the sense that even though Kimball has been using disposable aliases for 6 months, he still has to remind himself of who he's supposed to be. Only once, in the third season's episode called "Landscape with Running Figures," does Kimball make the mistake of forgetting his adopted name and signs in for work as Richard Kimball. Fear in a Desert City provides several other instances of Kimball's learning how to act like a fugitive. In the patrol car sequence in Act 3, Kimball displays remarkable composure throughout the entire time that Burton and Fairfield drive him home. Despite being pushed around, Kimball demonstrates his ability to think on his feet. "Put yourself in my place, a stranger. No one to vouch for me, no friend who's a lawyer," he tells Burton. "I can't demand a thing. I have to just sit here and take it." In this instance, he shows some of the savvy which he needs to survive pressure situations. Compare this to the sequence in Act 1, where Ed Wells makes Kimball flinch. He says, "What makes you think I was talking about you?" However, his triumph is quickly undermined. Kimball doesn't anticipate the detectives following him to the hotel. This is a mistake he will rarely make again. Naturally, he can't stop them from searching his room without calling attention to himself. In fact, the hotel search reveals the one vulnerable chink that Kimball can never quite mask. He usually acts very nervous and very guilty in front of the police. Again, David Johnson is excellent in this sequence. He looks completely shaken by the time the detectives leave Kimball's apartment. Stanford Whitmore was particularly pleased with Walter Grauman's direction of the sequence where Kimball confides in Monica Wells in Act 3. "If you look at that scene," says Stanford Whitmore, "Wally went away from the close-up of the agony of Richard Kimball having to say, 'I'm innocent.' I think part of it is played on Vera Miles's reaction. And then Kimball has one final little line. Just says, 'I was a doctor,' which is very close to self-pity, but David almost threw it away. It was so underplayed, yet I thought it was tremendously effective. When I saw it, I was really very impressed, because I said, this is something where the audience supplies all the sympathy, instead of having the character crammed down their throat, saying, 'Feel sorry for me, I'm innocent, I'm being hunted, I must always run.'" And that one scene is, I think, said Stanford Whitmore, the kind of thing you get from people who work together on a show and understanding what you're trying to get at. Walter Grauman deserves a lot of credit just for that one scene alone. Certainly the tight shots of Jansen's face capture Kimball's anguish and vulnerability. The eyes tell you everything. With the possible exception of the nightmare sequence from Nightmare at North Oak, which would air later that season, this is the only time Kimball actually shows just how much Lieutenant Gerard frightens him. As brilliant as David Jansen is in Fear in a Desert City, the pilot contains one sequence that didn't require a whole lot of acting. Keep an eye on David's reaction when Brian Keith throws him against the bus during their brawl in Act 4. Brian Keith hit him so hard that David broke 3 ribs, an early indication of the tremendous physical toll which the series would take on the 32-year-old soon-to-be star. Despite his inner conflict, his inherent instinct to do good versus the instinct to survive, the humanitarian Dr. Kimball is fairly easy to define. Whereas figuring out Lieutenant Philip Gerard is an entirely different matter. Because he appears in less than one-third of the series, there were 120 episodes, and Lieutenant Gerard appears rarely for more than a few minutes at a time. But his whole character, Lieutenant Gerard, is an enigma. And yet in some ways he's clearly the most fascinating character of the series. Some people have said, due to the manner in which he was played by yours truly, Barry Morse. But understanding what makes Gerard tick requires an understanding of the law as Lieutenant Gerard sees it. The police officer as an instrument of the law is a concept which is fundamental to the whole operation of any legal system. But it doesn't seem to be quite so readily accepted and understood among the public at large. At least, that's how I always felt. As a non-US citizen, you understand. As I see it, any society which has a legal, judicial system has actually 3 functions within it. It has the investigative process, which deals with the uncovering of crime and the apprehension of criminals. Then there is the judicial system, involving judges and juries, which disposes the punishment or acquittal of those charged with criminal offences. And then there's the prison system, which enforces whatever punishment has been decreed for this or that criminal act. Well, the police officer within that legal structure simply cannot permit himself to have any questions or doubts, because he must be, above and beyond everything else, quite impartial. A good many police officers in many societies have got into deep, deep trouble by allowing their partiality to influence their actions. Lieutenant Gerard would say that it's no part of his business to question the decisions of a jury as to the guilt or otherwise of a person who's been charged with a crime. His function as a police officer is to make sure that the process laid down by the judge and the jury is carried out. In other words, he's a functionary or an instrument of the law. He's involved in the carrying out of the law, not in the making of it. If any aspect of the law needs to be changed, if the decision of a given judge or a given jury needs to be challenged, of course there are processes of appeal and there are processes of review in the law. Not revocable if you happen not to agree with capital punishment. But those are perfectly legitimate questions. But, says Lieutenant Gerard, I think, these questions do not concern me in my function as a police officer. As he himself said in the pilot, let others debate and conclude. I was an instrument of the law and still am. Well, Lieutenant Gerard's steadfast, rigid interpretation of his role as an instrument of the law enables us to understand, at least partially, why he's so insistent on capturing Kimball himself. Despite the freak nature of the accident to the train, Lieutenant Gerard holds himself personally responsible somehow for Kimball's escape. The accident which prevented the law from carrying out its proper conclusion, the convicted murderer meeting his end, is beyond Lieutenant Gerard's control, and yet somehow he blames himself for it. And so finding Kimball and bringing him to execution becomes Gerard's personal mission. Some would say his obsession. In his first scene with Paul Birch as Captain Carpenter, I played Gerard as a man with a kind of quiet determination. A rather far cry from the way that sequence originally went. I first wrote Lieutenant Gerard as a little like Captain Ahab in Moby Dick, said Stanford Whitmore. But of course I didn't know Barry Morse was going to play him. And I remember, he said, watching the first cut of the pilot with Quinn Martin and Wally Grauman, and there was this one scene where Lieutenant Gerard is on one side of this glass map and the captain is on the other and asks him to take a vacation. And Gerard nearly bites his head off. I mean, Barry played it like a raving lunatic. And Quinn said, hey, this guy should be hospitalized. And then Quinn said to me, Stan, for God's sake, Barry Morse is used to acting on the stage. You give him something a little extreme. Because after all, the pilot script describes Gerard as a man whose dedication borders on fanaticism. Give him something like that, said Quinn Martin, and he'll really get into it. So I rewrote the scene just to try and calm the character down a little bit, because Barry was playing it as it was written and as Wally directed it. So we reshot that scene. And I can remember that first performance in that first episode. It was, I think, somewhat over the top. But there were two things, you see, at issue. One was the purely superficial, theatrical presentation of the character, which was served up, in my view, in a rather stereotyped Hollywood manner. It was complete even with the fedora hat and the raincoat. But the other was from Les Misérables, where you have Javert being presented as someone who, by modern psychiatric standards, probably should be hospitalized. Well, as we continued to work on the pilot, it began to appear to a fair number of people, as well as to myself, quite independently, that there was something other and better and rather less stereotypical that could be made out of this character, Gerard. It didn't have to be just a snarling, snappy, obsessive antagonist, because there'd be more life in the whole thing if he were a somewhat more complex character. And so, gradually, we began to add other colours to the character. I remember some of the ways in which we added colours over the course of the series. I remember I used to get mail from viewers who had noticed that over a period of time I would use either hand to write or to operate things with. Now, I'm instinctively left-handed, but I had developed a certain degree of ambidexterity, partly because they used to beat me at school, try and force me to write in my right hand. So I thought that it might be interesting and intriguing to viewers if I showed a certain degree of ambidexterity as being a sort of outward sign of this somewhat divided nature which poor Philip Gerard had. And so, perhaps some months apart, if I was involved in writing something, I would, in one instance, use my left hand, and then, later on, in another instance, use my right. And then I remember I also used to use glasses as time went by. My own glasses, they happened to be, because more often than not, I had with me in my pocket. And it seemed to me that it might be a bit of a hint of the march of time, as it were, if one started to see Lieutenant Gerard wearing glasses. But then, of course, the interpretation of the character began to emerge in some more subtle, less tangible ways. And I hope that I found some ways of illustrating Gerard's sense of dichotomy, his own instinctive responses to situations set against the code which he'd drilled himself to observe so rigidly as the series progressed. Well, aside from David Janssen's performance, the most captivating aspect of The Fugitive is perhaps the stirring theme music composed by jazz artist Peter Rugolo. Since the Arts and Entertainment Cable Network began rebroadcasting the series in 1990, at least three Fugitive fan clubs have been formed, and the topic that fans most want to know about is always the series' music. John Elizalde, who was Quinn Martin's music supervisor, called me and came to my house and told me that he wanted me to look at the pilot, said Pete Rugolo, who was scoring music for Universal Television at the time. Well, prior to moving into television, Pete Rugolo was a musical director at Mercury Records, where he arranged for and directed such jazz greats as Billy Eckstein, Sarah Vaughan, Patti Page, and Stan Kenton. Well, I looked at The Fugitive pilot and I liked it, and I decided to do it, said Pete Rugolo. They had me write about 2 or 3 hours of music and told me what they wanted, showed me the main title, how Kimball would be running a lot during the series, so I came up with the idea of a Fugitive theme at the beginning. But because Rugolo was under contract at Universal, he wasn't able to come into the Goldwyn Studios, where The Fugitive was filmed, to score each episode individually. At Universal, I scored every picture, and I looked at it, talked it over with the producer and the director, he explained. But for The Fugitive, no. All I actually saw was the pilot. They gave me a few scripts, and they gave me an idea of what the show would be about, and so I wrote several cues based on The Fugitive's theme. You know, sad versions, neutral versions, chases, a love theme, story music, you know, the kind of music you hear when the radio is playing, every possible kind of theme and variation. And I also wrote a theme for Lieutenant Gerard. It was a sort of threatening police theme, blah, 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 blah. So that any time you saw Gerard, they'd start off with the police theme. On the basis of watching the pilot episode, Rugolo composed a library of music that music director Elizalde and music editor Ken Willoit drew from as they scored the episodes. Rugolo did not, however, write all the music used on the series. In those days, he says, you were able to buy other libraries of music, since there were so many shows and so many hours of music available. They could deal with the publisher, and they'd get little arrangements on those kind of things as the show went on. They used all the thematic material that I wrote for The Fugitive, but there were other things they needed that I didn't write. The series actually used music that had been featured on such other shows as Gunsmoke and The Twilight Zone and The Outer Limits. And because the Musicians' Union at that time permitted American television studios to record music for their shows in different countries, John Elizalde arranged to have The Fugitive music recorded in London, England. However, Rougarou was unable to record the music himself. In those days, he said, they also had a law that the composer for the United States could not conduct the music over there. So Johnny Elizalde supervised it and had someone else conduct the music. They used a big symphony orchestra with wonderful musicians, and they did a beautiful job. The then music editor, Ken Willoit, would then put the music where he needed it, and he did a wonderful job. They made me sound good. Rougarou never released an album of his own based on the compositions for The Fugitive, and that's kind of a sad story, he recalled. I was asked by Warner Brothers to make an album of The Fugitive, because in those days they were recording a lot of those albums with TV themes. The producer called me and I wrote all the different arrangements and I had set up a recording date with him. But the producer got fired at the last moment and for some reason Warners didn't want to go through with it. I probably should have called around some companies to see if they were interested, but I never followed through. I still have a whole album of music for The Fugitive sitting in my basement. It's a shame it was never recorded because I think it would have been a pretty good album. It's safe to say that many people would agree. Pete Rougarou was pleased to hear that 30 years later, his compositions for The Fugitive continue to have a great impact on the fans. Oh, that's wonderful, he said. I think it really does help to create the mood of the show.
Fuge Facts. Television scholar David Thorburn watched Fear in a Desert City with Quinn Martin as part of an interview with the producer in 1978. Martin was very proud of his ability to choose actors who were appropriate to the medium of television, he said. At a certain point during the interview, he said, "Well, how about if we go and look at a segment of The Fugitive?" And we went into a projection room and we watched the first episode. At various points, he stopped the film and we talked about what we had seen, what sorts of effects he had aimed for, and so forth. Martin stopped the film at the end of the patrol car sequence with Jansen, Harry Towns, and Dabbs Greer. After we looked at this scene, Martin said, "Look, this is an example of how I think performance on television operates," said Thorburn. He pointed to Dabbs Greer and Harry Towns as examples of actors who projected a kind of internal danger. They were able to project an air of menace, something from within. Martin also emphasized the extent to which they were not conventionally handsome performers. He thought that added to the air of menace and danger they projected. You can feel a sadistic quality in the way the cops question Kimball in that scene, and the quietness with which they speak reinforces that element. Martin felt that this sequence was one of the most important scenes of the entire series, according to Thorburn. He felt that this scene explained the heart of The Fugitive's appeal. That all human beings feel guilty in a vague way without knowing what they're guilty of, explained Thorburn. Although Martin never invoked Kafka, it was clear to me that he understood The Fugitive dramatized the fear that ordinary people have of authority in general, and the sense that authority is potentially dangerous to them, even if they're innocent. Martin was proud of the scene because he felt it dramatized that subject very clearly. It established an assumption on which the rest of the series would be based. Paul Birch appears in Fear in a Desert City as Captain Carpenter, the only character on The Fugitive besides Richard Kimball who has any sort of control over Lieutenant Gerard. Although his scenes are brief and his lines accordingly scant, Birch manages to carry some weight to his role, perhaps due to the actor's imposing build. In Carpenter's only scene, he questions Gerard's motivation behind pursuing Kimball. He suspects that Gerard thinks the one-armed man really exists. Although Carpenter never gets Gerard to admit his reasons for keeping the Kimball matter alive, the captain will continue to ask this question in subsequent episodes. Because Carpenter respects Gerard's abilities as a police officer, he continues to grant the lieutenant leave to follow Kimball-related leads. But the captain is no jellyfish. He also requires Gerard to be back in Stafford within a couple of days to return to the other cases at hand. And even pulls rank on Gerard in the episode, "The End is But the Beginning." Although Morse and Janssen became good friends off the set, ABC tried to discourage them from being seen together in public because that was considered bad for the series. Our paths didn't cross all that often within the series, said Morse, but the network was very much concerned about the possibility of our being seen in each other's company socially. They really took this sort of thing seriously. It would be as if King Lear was seen taking his daughters to dinner on his night off. In 1964, Pocketbooks published Fear in a Desert Town, an unauthorized adaptation of the pilot that took many liberties with Stanford Whitmore's screenplay to create a much different, but less satisfying, story. Among the noticeable changes, Ed Wells is renamed Mark Wells. Monica Wells is reduced to a spineless, pathetic whimperer. While she certainly deserves pity, as painted by Fuller, she suffers from such lack of self-esteem. She resignedly accepts her husband's abuse that you almost wish Kimball wouldn't bother with her. The waitress Evelyn and bar owner Cleve, who are little more than walk-ons in the pilot, become major characters. Evelyn is Kimball's love interest, including a one-night stand, while Cleve assists Kimball in his escape at the conclusion of the story. Carpenter, Burden, and Fairfield are all given first names, Ed, Elroy, and Wilson, respectively. Burden and Fairfield are considerably more sleazy. They accept a bribe not only from Wells, but from anyone else with a little money. After escaping from the train wreck, Kimball stumbles onto a satchel full of money. Gerard absolutely hates Kimball. In a pointed bit of dialogue, he tells Kimball how much he resents doctors. Fuller also suggests that Kimball hated Helen. Roy Huggins didn't like the Pocketbook's adaptation for another reason, copyright infringement. Although he had relinquished the TV rights to The Fugitive, Huggins kept all other property rights, including merchandise rights. Huggins won a lawsuit against Pocketbooks. No other adaptation based on the series ever appeared. Act 3, The Episodes. First season, 1963-1964. In the beginning, it was very tough, recalled producer Alan Armour. You're struggling to find out what your series is, what kind of stories you can tell, what kind of stories work, what kind of stories don't work. You're making some mistakes and you're having some victories, so the first year was kind of uneven. From the production end, that would seem to be the case. The Fugitive underwent several changes in personnel during its first weeks on the air, but the episodes themselves were excellent, and after several weeks, the series began to build a solid and loyal audience. By the end of the season, The Fugitive established itself as one of the most popular programs on the ABC television network, with an average of 21 million viewers a week. The audience was terribly involved with the series, said Armour. The rooting interest for Kimball was stunning. We'd get letters and phone calls pleading with us to let the poor devil have another trial. In response, executive producer Quinn Martin commissioned Stanford Whitmore to write The Girl from Little Egypt, a prequel to the pilot episode in which Kimball flashes back to the trial and the night of the murder. Whitmore recalls coming up with the idea behind the most visually striking element of the opening sequence of the first season episodes. In the sessions with Quinn, where we would just sort of sit around Quinn's office and put our feet up, he said, I remember saying, hey, Quinn, what if Kimball comes out of the train wreck and magically the handcuffs just sever? But part of them are still on his wrist. And the light flashed off his handcuffs, and it jumps out and becomes the title. And Quinn said, hey, that's a great idea. Let's do it. And I said, can you do it? He said, sure, they can do anything in the lab. It was just kind of an idle remark, an easy suggestion. I said, well, why not? Because I usually don't concern myself with stuff like that. But Quinn liked it, and he said, let's do it that way. David Janssen's consistently engaging performances won him the first of three Emmy nominations. Janssen was also recognized by the readers of TV Guide, who named him Best Dramatic Actor in the magazine's annual poll, and of TV Radio Mirror, who named him Best Male Star of 1964. The Fugitive also won TV Guide's Silver Bowl Award for the best new series.
Second season, 1964 to 1965. The Fugitive continued to enjoy its extraordinary success throughout its second season. Taking a cue from the fans, whose enthusiastic response to the first year's episodes that either brought Kimball home, such as Home is the Hunted, or provided background information, like The Girl from Little Egypt, the fans' enthusiasm was enormous, and producers Alan Armour and his writers created several other stories that returned the Fugitive to his past, such as episodes like The World's End, The Survivors, May God Have Mercy. And of particular interest this season is the outstanding Escape into Black, in which Kimball has to return to his past in order to regain his memory after an accident renders him amnesiac. David Janssen delivers a very powerful performance in this episode, especially in the sequence where Kimball struggles to recover his identity amidst an onslaught of oral recollections of his trial. The second season is also marked by an entirely new opening title sequence. Each segment begins with a short clip, called in the trade a teaser, from the episode, and then segues into a silhouette taken from a still frame from the episode Nightmare at North Oak of Kimball running into a dark alley. And this silhouette would become a sort of logo for the Fugitive for the remainder of the series. A timpani drum roll accompanies the silhouette, followed by William Conrad's booming delivery of what must be the most famous run-on sentence in television history. The Fugitive, a QM production, starring David Janssen as Dr. Richard Kimball, innocent victim of blind justice, falsely convicted for the murder of his wife, reprieved by fate when a train wreck freed him en route to the death house, freed him to hide in lonely desperation, to change his identity, to toil at many jobs, freed him to search for a one-armed man he saw leave the scene of the crime, freed him to run before the relentless pursuit of the police lieutenant obsessed with his capture. American audiences continued to watch The Fugitive in record numbers. By the end of the 1964-65 season, The Fugitive ranked number 5 among the top 25 programs in network television. I remember it often seemed to me that there wasn't anybody on this planet back then who wasn't watching The Fugitive. Public recognition was enormous, just enormous. Of course, when I was traveling, as I frequently did, back and forth to Los Angeles, I was exposed all the time to the responses of the public, and sometimes quite alarmingly fervent they were. People responded, of course, quite predictably, with great hostility towards me personally. And sometimes, if it got too awkward, I'd revert to my own native English accent and even exaggerate it a bit, saying things like, "Oh, no, you've got it wrong. I'm not that television actor. I'm actually an academic. I'm over here doing a course at your university, Yale, there, and I'm just on my way back to England. But I do understand that there's some actor on television, Barry something or other, who bears some resemblance to me, but I'm afraid I'm not him." I'd do a bit of a performance like that just to get out of it if people were too demanding or too aggressive, which they quite often were.
People would walk up to me and ask, "How's your brother?" And I, who played Donna Kimball Taft, the Fugitive's sister, I'd say, "I haven't got a brother or sister. I'm an only child." And then the nickel dropped. I got used to that.
Well, The Fugitive ended its second season as the number 5 rated program on television, with an overall Nielsen rating of 27.9, which means that nearly one out of every 3 American households owning television sets that year tuned in every Tuesday night to watch The Fugitive. But, of course, The Fugitive's incredible popularity was not confined to the States alone. The program was broadcast in more than 70 countries worldwide, and David Janssen was recognized as an international symbol of hope and freedom. Quite fittingly, the Hollywood Foreign Press Association in 1965 awarded Jensen the Golden Globe Award for Best Male Television Star of the Year.
Third season, 1965-1966. 1965-66 was a rewarding season for The Fugitive on two levels. The series averaged a 40% share of its time slot. This means that all of the households with televisions whose sets are in use at 10 p.m. on Tuesdays, the program's time slot in the United States, 40% of those households were tuned into The Fugitive. The series won a Raven Award for the Mystery Writers of America as the best mystery show of the season. Finally, on May 22, 1966, the National Academy of Television Arts and Sciences named The Fugitive the best dramatic series of 1965-66, a definitive retort to everyone who had ever doubted that Roy Huggins' repulsive series concept would ever be accepted by the television public. For producer Alan Armour, receiving the Emmy statue was one of the crowning achievements of an exciting career. He would subsequently leave the series to produce The Invaders for Quinn Martin. The Fugitive was a very rewarding series, he said. It's very gratifying when you do a successful series. People leave you alone. They figure you know the answer. When you do a series that is not successful, everybody has the answer and everybody's prepared to tell you exactly what you're doing wrong. The Fugitive was a series that in the beginning ABC was watching very closely. After a while, they backed off and let us do pretty much anything we wanted to. And it was lovely. By the third year, Quinn figured we knew what we were doing and left us alone. Because the awards telecast aired 3 hours later on the West Coast, Armour's children did not find out that their father had won the Emmy until much later in the evening. Armour could have called them with the news, but he wanted to surprise them. All the time while my kids were watching the show, they never knew I had won, he recalled. They were really knocked out. David Jansen and director of photography Meredith Nicholson also received Emmy nominations this season. Not only did the Television Academy bestow the Emmy, its highest honor, on The Fugitive, other producers began flattering the series by creating similar programs, each featuring a wandering protagonist who helps the people he encounters. Among these fugitive-like shows was Run for Your Life, created by Roy Huggins and starring Ben Gazzara as an attorney who travels the world helping people after learning he himself only has 2 years to live. Aside from the numerous awards and honors, the third season of The Fugitive is marked by one noticeable change, the disappearance of Police Captain Carpenter, Gerard's commanding officer. No explanation was ever given for Carpenter's departure, and since the character was little more than a mouthpiece for 2 years, occasionally asking for the viewer's sake what Gerard really thought about Kemble, none was really required. However, Carpenter's presence did create the sense that Gerard couldn't just run around willy-nilly following up on every reported sighting of Richard Kemble. The lieutenant had to answer to someone. The elimination of the police captain, in effect, makes Gerard a more formidable opponent precisely because he no longer has to answer to a superior officer. There was never any question Gerard was the Indiana detective in charge of Richard Kemble. That was his only job, added novelist Stephen King.
Fourth season, 1966 to 1967. In April 1966, top-level entertainment programming executives from ABC in New York announced that The Fugitive would have several changes when it returned for its fourth season in the fall. The most noticeable change would be the switch to color from black and white, as part of the ABC's network commitment to color broadcasting. Every episode of the fourth season would begin with a tag emphasizing that the program would appear in color. And another announcement discussed plans to shoot episodes in such exotic locales as Mexico, Puerto Rico, and Hawaii. The most intriguing announcement of all would have changed the entire complexion of the series. apparently concerned that The Fugitive was not drawing enough young viewers, a survey conducted from October 1965 to February 1966 indicated that the programme averaged nearly 17.5 million adult viewers every week, ABC disclosed plans to broaden the programme's base of appeal by giving Dr. Kimball a young son. However, in a news conference in May of 1966, the network announced that it had realised that given the spectre of Lieutenant Gerard, burdening Dr. Kimball with a son was an idea that just wouldn't work. Stanford Whitmore, who wrote the pilot episode, Fear in a Desert City, thinks that The Fugitive lost some of its dramatic edge when it made the switch from black and white to colour. To me, he says, The Fugitive was essentially a mood piece, and the black and white shows really brought out that element. I felt that the show became a little too pretty when it switched to colour, and that it lost a lot of the moodiness that was created by black and white. Producer George Eckstein, who along with Alan Armour had left the series at the end of the third season, also adds, from an aesthetic point of view, the black and white did bring a dimension to the drama that was lost by the switch to colour. But from a practical point of view, we had to make the switch, because most of the network shows by that time were broadcast in colour, and that became the rule rather than the exception. With the switch to shooting in colour, an already expensive series began to cost even more to produce. The film itself not only costs more, but the film processing and print and editing costs are also much higher, explained our assistant director, Bob Rubin. Because we could no longer use our huge library of stock footage from the first 3 years, which was all shot in black and white, editor Carl Barth, who was also our second unit director, and I spent many a freezing night shooting drive-bys and cutaways and establishing shots and photographic process plates. These are used in the background of interior car scenes, which are actually shot in the studio. And these we had to reshoot for use on our rear projection dialogue scenes in colour. The fourth season brought several other changes to the series, including a new producing team of Wilton Schiller and John Meredith Lucas, both formerly of Ben Casey, and a new director of photography, Robert Hoffman. As part of a gradual slant towards action-oriented series, the new team added new wrinkles, such as establishing a $10,000 reward for The Fugitive and incorporating Fred Johnson, that's the one-armed man, into more stories. The shift towards action played up the chase element, leading to some exciting moments in such episodes as The Ivory Maze, in which Kimball narrowly misses capturing his elusive prey. But the new producers experienced many other difficulties, particularly with the scripts, and the series was adversely affected as a result. The biggest problem that plagued the Schiller-Lucas scripts was a matter of approach. The early fourth season episodes veered more towards the melodramatic, that was Quinn Martin's term for plot elements, and away from emotional, the pivotal element that enabled the programme to reach the viewers. I suppose Wilton's attitude was that this was more of a melodrama than it was a drama, said George Eckstein. That would have been reflected in that kind of change from emotion to melodrama. Eckstein believes the change in approach was not so much a deliberate attempt to put a new stamp on the show, but rather a subconscious reflection of a new producer's style. That sort of thing, he says, happens unconsciously when there's no plan for it. You don't start the season with an overview. You don't start the season saying, well, what are we going to do that's different? How are we going to approach the scripts differently? But Wilton, as the producer, for the most part, brought in a whole different set of writers than Alan had. Eckstein continues. Most producers in town have certain writers that they call upon again and again to write their scripts. And Allen and Wilton were two different people that never crossed paths. So the individual writers that Wilton brought in were a whole different group than the writers who'd been writing the show for the first 3 years. Except for me, George Eckstein. And so you get a different point of view and a different attitude as communicated from the producer to the writer as to what the show is about. I don't know whether one is superior to the other, but the first 3 years probably were more personal dramas than those in the last year, which was of a melodramatic line. Executive producer Quinn Martin, however, apparently believed that the first approach was better than the new approach. Without the emotional drive that fueled the first 3 seasons, the quality of the writing suffered considerably. Even though The Fugitive still enjoyed healthy ratings, Quinn Martin was concerned enough about the writing to ask Eckstein to return to the series as co-producer and help Wilton Schiller with the scripts. George is a superb writer and he knew the series, said Alan Armour. He was the perfect choice to go in and help Wilton Schiller. The odd man out was John Meredith Lucas. I was not completely happy in the organisation, and I felt that I would rather work outside it, he said. Well, ironically, Lucas left at the point where he and Schiller were beginning to grasp the particular subtleties of The Fugitive. Their final 2 episodes together, called Nobody Loses All the Time and 10,000 Pieces of Silver, were emotionally strong stories whose dramatic pull came from Dr. Kimball's interaction with the characters. These episodes captured some of the flavour of the first 3 seasons. Lucas, who later went on to produce and direct several episodes of the original Star Trek television series, would return to The Fugitive as a writer and director later in the 4th season.
Act 4, the day the running stopped. Finally, Kemble, the end game, or who really killed Helen Kemble? The Fugitive will be a series which will be brought to a planned conclusion, that conclusion being, of course, Richard Kemble's release from his predicament and the ultimate salvation of justice. Series creator Roy Huggins from his original 1960 series concept. While the idea to end The Fugitive with a definitive concluding episode clearly belongs to Roy Huggins, the decision to proceed with the finale was Quinn Martin's call all the way. Martin felt that, given the enormous emotional investment that viewers from over 70 countries poured into the program, he owed it to the audience to give them the conclusion they wanted. Richard Kemble had to find the man who killed his wife, Helen. Richard Kemble's name had to be cleared. But if Martin had had to do it again, he would not have ended The Fugitive as he did. Martin felt that the resolution of the story ultimately hurt the series' syndication value. I think Quinn was of two minds, said co-producer George Eckstein. One of the problems was that his sister was dying of cancer at the time, and he was very close to her. He was going through a painful experience, and so his focus was not that much on the preparation of the series. He knew what we were doing and all that, but he wasn't really on top of it. Afterwards, Quinn said he wouldn't have ended the series the way he did. On the one hand, he felt that we should have, in order to satisfy the audience. But from a financial point of view, he felt it was a mistake because it was difficult getting the series into syndication, at least the first few years after it ended, because everybody figured, well, we know how it ended. The revival of The Fugitive on the A&E cable television network has erased any lingering doubt as to the series' magnetism. The response to the reruns, which began airing in 1990, has been tremendously positive. Many viewers have either telephoned or written the network with their feedback, particularly in early 1992 when A&E's rights to the series were about to expire. But the bottom line, as usual, in television, is the ratings. The key reason behind A&E's decision in 1992 to renew their rights to the program was that The Fugitive was one of the most highly rated programs in the cable channel's daytime lineup at that time. "I think the show has proved Quinn wrong," Eckstein said. "It's achieved a kind of cult status over the years, and maybe because of that, it's made as much money with a closed ending as it would have if it had been with an open ending." Although a Cleveland newspaper columnist reported in January 1967 that The Fugitive was one of those shows said to be headed for cancellation, the show's ratings were still healthy enough to merit renewal for a fifth year. ABC wanted another season, but David Janssen pulled the plug. "The Fugitive didn't go beyond 4 years because David was just exhausted," said Richard Anderson. "He was a shell of himself by the time it ended. I talked to post-production head Arthur Fellows about this on the set one day, and he said, 'We'll never do another show with one person again because you just put too much on one person.' David was in nearly every shot, and I think it just wore him down. In addition, it was a night show, so he was working at night a lot of the time, and I think that broke his health. I think they wanted another year, but David just wasn't able to do it." David must have been the hardest worked actor in any series it's ever been, added Barry Morse. "I know that he was always immensely relieved whenever I turned up in town because it meant that he was going to get a few days off." When Martin's first choice to write the finale, Don Brinkley, was unavailable, the assignment went to Eckstein, who had already contributed 9 scripts, and Michael Zager, who had written for other series, Ben Casey, but not for The Fugitive. "I didn't know Michael at the time," said Eckstein. "Quinn had evidently seen a pilot of his that didn't sell and liked his work, so he asked the two of us to work together on the final show." The judgment has been criticized by many as being illogical. Why would Gerard grant Kimball a reprieve, they ask? And why would the one-armed man climb up the tower in order to get away? Eckstein acknowledges that the script isn't perfect. However, he and Zager had very little time to write it, a factor that the critics have apparently overlooked. Even under normal circumstances, writing for television requires a quick turnaround time, because the decision to end The Fugitive did not come until very late in the season. Eckstein and Zager had to work faster than usual. That they still contributed an excellent script is a remarkable achievement. That script was not prepared at the beginning of the season, which is usually the case with TV series, said Eckstein. Back then, the deadline for ordering a new season was around Washington's birthday, and the series would go on in September. You'd have the luxury of time, 6 to 8 months, to prepare those scripts. But the judgment wasn't prepared until the end of the season, around late January or early February 1967. By the time the decision was made to end the series, we didn't have much time. We were being rushed to finish that script. There are a few elements to the story that Eckstein would have fixed if time had permitted one last revision. We had to find an amusement park in Indiana where the show was supposed to take place, he explained. We ended up shooting at Pacific Ocean Park on the Santa Monica Pier. And we were trying desperately to hide the Pacific Ocean, which wasn't easy. There were other sequences and elements of that story that I wish I'd been able to do a more graceful job with. But it sure got its audience. To the hardcore fans of The Fugitive, there was never any question as to who had killed Helen Kimball. The guilt of the one-armed man had been established piece by piece over the course of the series. But that didn't stop all sorts of rumors implicating other characters from surfacing. Everyone wanted it to be Gerard, said Eckstein. Quinn thought that was nonsense because it would have made Kimball an idiot for chasing the wrong man for 4 years. If you think about it in those terms, all the speculation that it was Gerard who killed the wife didn't make any sense at all. The Fugitive was a show that was deeply rooted in reality. So having the one-armed man do it was the only way we really could have gone. But Martin wasn't adverse to making things a little interesting. When he learned that Len Taff, the fugitive's brother-in-law, was going to be implicated in the plot, Martin knew exactly who he wanted for the part. Early in my career, I had an ability to play heavies and good guys within the same part. I could bring out both sides of the same character, said Richard Anderson. I believe Quinn wanted me to play Lynn because he felt that I would have that sort of ambiguous effect upon the audience for that segment. I mean, Lynn was a nice guy, but I also played him in such a way that people would not quite know whether or not he was really involved in the murder. Even Las Vegas bookmakers got drawn into the frenzy. Anderson's brooding interpretation of the character made Lynn the favorite of Vegas odds makers during the week-long interim between Part 1 and Part 2. I don't remember what the odds were, but there were a lot of bets going on in Las Vegas on who did it, Anderson said. The smart person said, Lynn's a nice guy, it must be him, and I played it that way, too. There was a lot of money lost there. The wildest speculation as to who murdered Helen did not come until about 10 years after the judgment first aired. In his Chronology of Dramatic Television Programs, Television Drama Series Programming, A Comprehensive Chronicle, Larry Giancos concluded his summary of The Fugitive with a rather startling observation. We endured 118 hairbreadth escapes with Dr. Kemble only to discover that our hero was guilty after all. Giannakos based his conclusion on secondhand information he received from a man named Gerard Turner, who claimed to have worked with makeup artist Jack Wilson. According to Turner, David Jansen was so devastated by the assassination of John Kennedy in 1963 that he became a cynic in real life. From that point on, Jansen had decided that Dr. Kemble had indeed killed his wife and that the actor wanted to show this by having Kemble remove a prosthetic arm in the final scene of the series. Giannakos never met Jansen, so the key to this theory is determining whether Turner's claims are valid. I don't remember any Gerard Turner, said Wilson. He could be somebody I knew, but I can't really remember the name. There's no way to contact Turner for verification. Giannakos said he died in 1990. But that really wouldn't be necessary because the crux of his claims are not true. The person who made David out to be a dark person might have gotten his ire up at some time because he wasn't, said Wilson. David was very quiet and then he kept to himself, but he also liked to joke around. That story about wanting Kemble to remove his arm was completely a joke. That's all there was to it. I can believe that David was much affected by John Kennedy's death, added Stanford Whitmore. It was a tremendous shock. But to say that David thought it would be great if Kemble was really guilty and this is how he thought the series should end, I think that's silly. I wouldn't really put that kind of talk in the category of the kind of bull sessions that Quinn, David, and I used to have when we were building the pilot. The kind of free-floating attempts to get something that David would respond to. I can imagine, if he seemed a little frivolous at the time, that David might have said, oh, hey, I've got a great idea how to end this mess. I'm really guilty. David did that all the time. He had this very dry sense of humor. If he made such a remark, it was only kidding around. Nothing further should be made of it. Barry Morse agrees that any reference to Kemble removing a false arm was no more than an off-camera remark that was never meant to be taken seriously.
David and I were always somewhat mischievous by instinct. We were always cooking up japes, you know, schoolboy kinds of things that you do from time to time, especially if you're working as hard as we were at that time. You've got to have a few laughs. And we used to go on PR tours around the country to promote the series. Well, David didn't like doing these very much. He wasn't the sort of fellow who's as instinctively gabby as I am. So he used to rely on me to address all these people who had assembled in some conventional hall in Chicago or wherever it was, to tell them to keep on watching and keep on showing The Fugitive because it was going to get even better next season or whatever it was we were told to say. And David and I, we used to cook up various kinds of stunts that we would have liked to have done to liven up these things a bit. I remember one thing we used to talk about was how we would come onto the platform in one of these convention halls and David would have a sort of prosthetic piece built into his suit. And then after exchanging some polite chat with the local ABC boss or wherever we were, David and I would shake hands, walk off in opposite directions, and I'd be left holding his prosthetic false arm. Well, I suppose somewhere along the line, one or other of us must have talked to some journalist about pulling off that stunt, which, of course, would have sent ABC right through the roof. I mean, the idea of us sending up this sacred, devout, precious thing of theirs. But, I mean, you know, if you could have seen all those hundreds of men in their tight silk suits sitting there eating indigestible food and talking all kinds of nonsense to each other, you probably would have itched to do something like that too. But that was probably the genesis of the idea of the false arm. But unfortunately, it never came into being.
In a 1968 interview with director Ralph Nelson, Jansen himself put to rest any speculation as to what he meant by his remarks. You say things in jest, hoping that nobody will do much about it, except maybe laugh with you a little, he said. Then you find it's at print, and then somebody else picks it up, and all of a sudden you're quoted. Sometimes people don't understand the humor of the situation. They take it as reality. I said something to the effect that I was going to unscrew my arm and walk off into the sunset, having killed my wife. It was really sort of an irresponsible statement that I made just to have a laugh. And I found it cropping up in magazines and newspapers. Jansen also told Nelson that neither himself, Quinn Martin, or anyone else involved in the series had any preconceived notions how to end The Fugitive before the judgment came about. Morse corroborates this. We had far more important and pressing things to attend to than speculating about how the series was going to end, he said. We were lucky to know what the next week's script was going to be about.
Plot synopsis and backstory of The Judgment, Part 1. Prologue. How long can a man search before the search destroys him? To Richard Kimball, working for a trucking firm in Tucson, Arizona, defeat has never seemed so mockingly near. Months have passed, and the trail stays cold. There is no trace of the elusive hope he seeks. But sometimes, hope lies no further than the next truck. Synopsis. Gerard flies out to Los Angeles after Fred Johnson, the one-armed man, is arrested for armed robbery. Gerard hopes that a newspaper item about the arrest will bring Kimball, now alias Frank Davis, out to investigate. While Gerard questions Johnson about the Kimball murder, the fugitive notices the story in a Tucson newspaper and heads for California. Jean Carlyle, a court reporter, longtime friend of the Kimball family, soon discovers that Kimball is headed for a trap. She intercepts the fugitive at an L.A. produce market, just as the police close in. Later, after Johnson is bailed out of jail, the one-armed man murders his bail bondsman and skips town. Upon snooping around the bondsman's office, Kimball and Jean uncover a shocking piece of evidence, a bail bond receipt, apparently posted by Len Taft, the fugitive's brother-in-law. Kimball and Jean return to Jean's apartment to plan their next move. Gerard arrives to interrogate Jean, but she holds her own against the lieutenant. Gerard decides to investigate Jean's car and discovers a produce market box in the back seat. Moments later, Gerard arrests Kimball. Epilogue. A free man, Fred Johnson, boards a train that will take him east to Indiana, to Stafford. Hours later, two men board another train which will bring them to the same destination. For one of these, the moment of arrival will be one of grim and long-sought triumph. For the other, his homecoming will mark only one more stop on his way to a destiny decreed in a court of law 4 years before. Richard Kimball is on his way home and to an overdue appointment with death. Gerard momentarily loses his composure when he questions Johnson during Act One. After establishing that Johnson was in the vicinity of Stafford on the night of the murder, Gerard grabs the one-armed man by the shirt and asks him passionately, "Did you kill Helen Kimball?" What Gerard is saying in his emotional state is, tell me that you didn't do it," said George Eckstein. At least, that's what we intended in that scene. What Gerard wants to hear was that the one-armed man didn't do it, and that he's after the right guy in Kimball. He doesn't want to believe that the one-armed man could have done it, because that's been Kimball's alibi through the whole 4 years, and now he's got the one-armed man, and he doesn't want to believe that Kimball could possibly have been telling the truth all this time. Is Gerard beginning to believe that Kimball is innocent at this point in the story? No, not yet, says George Eckstein. He didn't believe it until the second part of the show, because just as Kimball has spent 4 years chasing the one-armed man, Gerard has spent 4 years chasing Kimball, and he would try to deny any possibility that Kimball could be innocent. Otherwise, his whole quest has been a mockery. The way Michael and I saw it, Gerard would have to deny the possibility of Kimball's innocence until the last possible moment. Gerard looks genuinely deflated when he arrests Kimball outside of Jean's apartment building at the end of Part One. There is no triumph in his voice, but rather a sense of ambivalence. For the first time in the series, Gerard apologizes to Kimball for doing his job as an instrument of the law. Eckstein says it wasn't that Gerard believed that Kimball was a heinous serial killer or anything like that. He was treating him at that moment as a human being rather than as an animal. Gerard may be obsessed, but he's not a savage hunter. He's gone through 4 years of tracing Kimball, so he knows that Kimball has left a string of good deeds behind him, if nothing else. And there's also a sense of resignation in Kimball's reaction to the arrest. He doesn't attempt to resist, as he sometimes had done. The attitude between these two was that this had been a gentlemanly quest between two opponents who respected each other. That attitude has been played out in other episodes. Each of them respected the other, regardless of the way they pursued or fled from one another. And at that moment, Kimball knew that Gerard had nailed him, and he couldn't do anything about it. Or perhaps, as he tells Jean earlier in the show, he really is tired of running.
Fuge family. I had just given birth to my second child at the time of production. My son Andrew was 3.5 weeks old. There was some discussion whether they'd bring me in because I was still pregnant at the time that they were setting up the last show. Although I wanted to do it because I always loved working on The Fugitive, I also didn't want to hold them up. After Andrew was born, there was another problem. I was nursing him. There was some talk about having a limo drive me to and from the set because I live very near the Goldwyn Studios where we shot the series. They finally decided it would be much easier if I brought Andrew with me, so they got me a suite of rooms on the lot. Andrew, the nurse, and I would trot off to work at 6 a.m. while my son Devon, who was 2 years old at the time, stayed home with the sitter. I was really perfectly amenable to what they did. On a few occasions, the production stopped so that I could nurse Andrew. Bob Rubin, our wonderful bachelor assistant director, just thought that it was great that I was taking care of my baby. So whenever it was time to feed Andrew, Bob would just yell, "Lunch break!" and everything would come to a screeching halt. Fuge facts and figures. Two elements of this episode serve as a kind of bookend to the pilot episode, Fear in a Desert City. First, we find Kimball working in Tucson, Arizona, the setting for the pilot. Next, the epilogue opens with footage of an oncoming train, a sequence very similar to the opening segment of the first season episodes. Gerard and Kemble sit in the same places as in that opening sequence. Kemble even glances at the window. Also, both are silent. Only the narrator is heard. According to Daily Variety, Part 1 registered a 37.2 rating and a 56.7 share in the United States. Part 2, Prologue. A man may travel many roads and one day find his way home again. But for Richard Kemble, this road is not of his choosing, and this day has come too soon. Two men traveling together, joined by the links of steel and the memory of a senseless murder committed years before, two hunters, one of whom has finally caught his elusive quarry. Synopsis. After convincing Gerard that Johnson is headed for Stafford, Kemble receives a 24-hour reprieve, one last chance to find the one-armed man and prove himself innocent. Meanwhile, Stafford City Planning Commissioner Lloyd Chandler learns about a phone call Donna received from a man who claimed that Lynn was with Helen on the night of the murder. Lloyd knows who made the call, Johnson, and why. Lloyd used Lynn's name to bail Johnson out of jail. In fact, Lloyd witnessed Johnson murdering Helen, but he was too paralyzed with fear to stop the beating. He remained silent because he didn't want to damage his reputation as a war hero. Lloyd meets Johnson that night at the stable, where the one-armed man demands $50,000 to be delivered the following day at an abandoned amusement park. Just as Kemble's reprieve is about to run out, Kemble and Gerard learn the truth about Lloyd from Lloyd's wife, Betsy. After Betsy tells them that Lloyd has decided to kill Johnson rather than pay him the money, Kemble and Gerard race to the amusement park to stop Lloyd and arrest the one-armed man before it's too late. Epilogue, Tuesday, August 29th, the day the running stopped. The following memo appeared on the last page of the teleplay to the judgment. To all QM staff, crew, actors, all guest actors, all ABC personnel, all advertising personnel. This script marks the end of a very exciting and successful enterprise, and I would appreciate it if everyone would keep the contents a secret and not discuss it with any members of the press or newscasters, except to acknowledge that it does prove Richard Kemble innocent. To any members of the press or any newscasters, if the above does not work and by chance you find out the contents of the script, please honor the industry code of not giving the ending away, except to say Richard Kemble will be proved innocent. Thank you. Warmest regards, Quinn Martin. Daily Variety reported it as a better-kept secret than classified U.S. atomic information. Quinn Martin, as his memos to the media and his own personnel indicate, was adamant about keeping the conclusion to the judgment a secret until the night the episode was broadcast. But apparently even Martin couldn't resist total silence because he tipped off the trade paper columnist that the one-armed man did it. Harriet Peters of Showtime reported the news in her column of August 18, 1967. "Well, when you think about it, there's no surprise ending," said George Eckstein. "I mean, it wasn't as if the sister did it. This simply couldn't be a surprise. Kemble was innocent, the one-armed man did it, and Gerard nailed him. It was exactly the way everyone should have expected." Martin, therefore, knew exactly what he was doing when he tipped off the press. He may have mentioned that the one-armed man did it, but he never said a thing about the key element of the story, the surprise witness, Lloyd Chandler. That would have given away the ending. "I was with David when he reviewed the script and found out what was going to happen in the end," said Assistant Director Bob Rubin. "As part of my work, I used to give him each script, review the endless rewrites with him, and update him with, you know, an overview of the week's show, the schedule, the cast. It was funny, he really didn't know how to play the final scene. The showdown with Bill Raisch, he said, 'You know, I've waited 4 years for this moment, and now I don't know how to play it. I'm not really sure how to do this. I mean, is he happy? Is he sad? Is he up? Is he down? It's like I finally caught up with this guy. And now I don't know what to do. David really personalized that moment, and there was a lot of emotion as he read that scene. I think he saw it as the end to a lot of memories. He kept saying, I don't know how to play this. I hope what I do will be okay. It certainly was. In the final scene of the series, after Kimball is exonerated, Gerard meets Kimball outside the courthouse, and the two men quietly shake hands. But the original plan was to have the two adversaries exchange a few parting words before going their separate ways.
Oh, in that first version of that final episode, I'm afraid our writers have gone a little overboard. They wrote a scene of quite emetic mawkishness, in which David and I said all sorts of sentimental things for each other. And so at one point, I remember, I suggested to David that in order to mock this overly sentimental dialogue, that we should throw ourselves into each other's arms and kiss each other firmly on the mouth. Well, we threatened that, but of course we never had to carry it out, because by that time we were all on such good terms with each other that everybody realized that this was a bit absurd, and it was agreed that we'd make some changes in the dialogue. And I think somebody said, well, now, what would be the best thing to say? And I said, well, I think it would be best, really, if we said nothing. As it's so often the case on the screen, what you do and what you look is so much more eloquent than what you merely say. So Gerard realizes that the Kimball matter is finally closed. And from that moment on, I think, as far as Lieutenant Gerard is concerned, Richard Kimball really ceases to be, it seemed to me. It's rather like Othello says in the last act. Othello's occupation's gone. The very raison d'être of what's been occupying him so obsessively for the whole of the last 4 years simply no longer exists. The Kimball case is now just one from the files. And from the point of view of a professional police officer, I think Gerard would simply be feeling, all right now, turn the page, and what's up next?
At the time the judgment was telecast throughout the United States, David Janssen was on location in Columbus, Georgia, shooting the film The Green Berets with John Wayne. 30 minutes after the final episode aired, Janssen appeared via satellite on Joey Bishop's late-night talk show on ABC-TV. I killed her, Joey, Janssen cracked. She talked too much. Bishop then asked Janssen how he felt after the series was finished. My feeling was not one of remorse, and it was not one of melancholy, Janssen said. For all of us involved in The Fugitive, we didn't feel as though we should sing sad songs because of the acceptance of the show. We all felt that everyone had done a good job, and now we're all going to go on to something better. Hopefully. It's a positive rather than a negative. 25 years later, Bob Rubin answered the same question from the crew's point of view. That last segment was an important show, he said. Even though we had worked on that show, it wasn't just work. We really cared. Lots of us really were involved in the emotion of the final show. Our sadness at the day the running finally stopped, however, was replaced by a sense of pride and a job well done, a show well done, and a season and a 4-year series well done. We did good. Fuge facts. Because of practical reasons, a film or dramatic TV script is never filmed in the sequence that we see whenever we watch it on the screen. You always get the exteriors out of the way first in case of bad weather, said Reuben. You shoot the exteriors first, then you go into the studio and do the interior scenes, where there's a total control of the lighting and not a drop of rain. The scene where Barry shoots Bill Raisch was one of the first things we shot. Then a few days later, we did the scene where David beats the confession out of Bill. The confession allegedly took place on top of a water tower at the amusement park, but we actually shot that scene on a set inside the studio. So the one-armed man was actually killed several days before he confessed.
Fuge. Foolery. I remember that we cooked up, David Jansen and I, in one of our mischievous moods, another possible ending to The Fugitive. We invented a kind of scenario where we'd establish a shot on a handsome suburban house in Stafford, Indiana, and it's moonlight, and you can hear a few crickets and all that sort of night noises. And we're on a high crane with the camera, and we push in, and we go through the upper bedroom window, and then we go tighter onto, let's say, the left-hand side of a double bed, where David, Richard Kimball, is just sitting up, very alarmed, having obviously just awakened. And then he turns on the light and turns and shakes the shoulder of his companion in this double bed, whom we see as she turns around and wakes up, is Helen, his wife, Mrs. Richard Kimball. And then David cries out, oh, honey, oh, thank God, I've just had the most terrible nightmare. Well, that was one wild idea that we had for a proposed ending to The Fugitive. Would have driven ABC mad, wouldn't it? Most of the audience, too.
Fuge, final facts and figures. David Jansen received his third Emmy nomination for Best Dramatic Actor. The award went to Bill Cosby for I Spy. August 29th, 1967, was the day the running stopped in the United States. However, because of problems encountered in dubbing the episode, other countries had to wait until sometime in September to see the finale. In West Germany, viewers had to wait until October. According to Daily Variety, Part 2 scored a 50.7 rating and a 73.2 share. ABC estimated that 26 million homes in America were tuned in to the finale.
The series creator, Roy Huggins' original 1960 description of the train wreck that freed Richard Kimball and his discussion of the philosophy of The Fugitive provided the whole basis of the presentation which he made to ABC Network President Leonard Goldenson during the 1962 meeting that led to the series premiere in 1963. Many of Roy Huggins' suggestions that he must change his appearance, that he must keep moving, that he must stay in this country, etc. Many of Roy Huggins' suggestions were followed to the letter. The most intriguing aspect of Huggins' presentation is the idea stated in the final sentence. Quote, "This will be a series which will be brought to a planned conclusion. That conclusion being, of course, Richard Kimball's release from his predicament and the ultimate salvation of justice." Although the idea for ending The Fugitive with a definitive final episode is generally attributed to executive producer Quinn Martin, it actually belonged to Roy Huggins. And amazingly, Huggins himself didn't realize this until he retrieved the presentation from a box of old files shortly before this book went to press. Roy Huggins himself says, "I'd completely forgotten about that last sentence. Hadn't seen the signature in 30 years. As it turns out, I'd filed it in a box marked Bus Stop," one of the series Huggins produced for 20th Century Fox. "And finding those pages after all these years was a very pleasant surprise." We are extremely grateful to Roy Huggins for allowing us to share these pages with you.
The Fugitive. This is a series format I wrote on September 19, 1960. My name is Roy Huggins. Fade in. Long shot train, night. A passenger train, its enormous headlight glowing in the distance, is racing toward camera through dark and lonely country. The rhythmic sound of the train rises swiftly as it approaches and passes camera, the heavy, cadence sound reaching a climax, which breaks off abruptly as we go into the passenger car, process, night. The rhythmic sound of the train continues in a lower key. Big close on Richard Kimball. He is a prematurely gray-haired man in his mid-30s. His eyes are turned toward the dark window where broad farmland, with its occasional solitary glow of light, swiftly passes. But we sense from his inward air that he is seeing little of this, that whatever beauty there may be in the swift passage of quiet, moonlit countryside has no meaning for him. From the beginning of this close shot, we have heard the offstage voice of a narrator, a voice suggesting an infinite detachment, which gives it the authority of a disinterested, omniscient observer. Narrator. This man is known by a number, 565-9880. His name is Richard Kimball. Once a doctor. Specialty, pediatrics. The camera has drawn back over this to reveal the man next to Kimball and two men in the seat immediately behind him. These men are all members of the state's attorney's office, and in their varying ways they suggest precisely what they are. They look neither grim nor watchful. They are doing their jobs, thinking their private thoughts. Narrator. He is returning from his fourth and final appeal from a conviction on a charge of murder in the first degree. The victim, Helen Kimball, his wife. Two shot, Kimball and officer. The police officer beside him, using his left hand, offers a cigarette to Kimball and takes one himself. He lights both cigarettes with a lighter, using the same left hand. During this action, we may notice a light top coat covering Kimball's left forearm and the officer's right forearm. The camera does not single this out because the action itself suggests that the unseen wrists are joined by handcuffs. Narrator. Richard Kimball had offered only this defense. He had caught one brief glimpse of the actual criminal, a gaunt and red-haired man. This was the simple but unprovable truth. The provable truth was that Helen and Richard Kimball were childless and bitterly estranged by his determination to change that condition through adoption. Big close on Kimball. Narrator. Crimes without plan, motive, or evidence are not only insoluble, they often victimize the innocent. Richard Kimball is returning to death row, state prison. Execution date, 10 a.m., July 18. No further appeals are possible. Exterior, the train. It passes camera, the sound almost deafening once again. As the train roars away from camera, the whistle sounds, an eerie, fading wail. Narrator. But this train is the Capital Limited, and this is the tragic night of July 2. Close shot, a railroad switch. Close shot, the engine of the Capital Limited. The whistle sounds again. Close shot, a division in the track showing the rails set for a 15-degree turn onto a spur line. Interior of the train, the four men, silent, utterly unaware of what awaits them. Exterior of the train, it is still traveling at headlong speed. Another angle as the train takes the unintended turn onto the spur. The wreck. We hold only for the first shocking impact and go into an effect dissolve. Exterior, empty countryside, night. We dissolve into a shot designed for the maximum effect of tranquility. The night sounds are distant, undisturbed. Into shot, the figure of a man stumbles, and as the figure comes into a close shot, we recognize Richard Kimball. Breathless, he stops. We see his face clearly in the moonlight. He is bewildered, emerging from shock. He stands for a moment, listening, and as full realization of what has happened rises in him, he turns as if expecting to find the wreckage of the train behind him. We see nothing. We hear nothing but the sounds of the crickets and an occasional nightbird. Closer on Kimball, as we see him face the almost terrifying fact of freedom. He glances quickly around him, then begins to run. The camera holds and the music begins. As his figure recedes, we see an odd configuration in the distance into which he is vanishing. This jagged configuration begins to move toward us swiftly as the music rises. The configuration becomes two sharply, violently formed words, which finally fill the screen. The Fugitive. We hold for the musical climax and fade out. The foregoing is the cinematic signature of a proposed new hour-long series, The Fugitive. Each week, this 70-second introduction will excitingly restate the premise and reset the mood of the series. Each episode will deal with a week, a month, a day, or an hour in the life of Richard Kimball as a fugitive. A life which involves flight, search, moral dilemma, friendship, love, laughter, all underlain with unfulfillment, danger, and tragedy. In a heightened and imaginative sense, Kimball's life as a fugitive will relate to deep and responsive drives, needs, and fantasies in the American audience, not the least of which is that Kimball lives with alienation and anxiety. But in this case, they are real and can be dealt with. At the heart of the series is the preoccupation with guilt and salvation, which has been called the American theme. Kimball is pursued, and in the eyes of the law, he is guilty. But no American of any persuasion will find him so. The idea of natural law is too deeply embedded in the American spirit for anyone to question Kimball's right, after all recourse to law has been exhausted, to preserve his own life. Even Hobbes, that great philosopher of authoritarianism, acknowledged one circumstance in which a man has a right to resist Leviathan, when an attempt is made to take his life on mistaken grounds. In the summer of 1960, it became abundantly clear that the Western on television was about to undergo an eclipse. I had given much thought to the broad and durable appeal of the Western, and I concluded that the essence of that appeal lay solely in the character and mode of life of the Western hero. That hero is a man without roots, without obligation, without fixed goals, without anxiety about his place in the order of things. He not only avoids commitment to one locale, one occupation, or one woman, but he actually seems compelled to change his dwelling place, his occupation, his human attachments. This implicit factor of willed irresponsibility without a concomitant sense of guilt is the element of basic appeal in the Western. The good versus evil formula, the omnipotence of the hero, these elements are found in contemporary melodrama, but not the element of absolute freedom that the traditional Western contains. Shane is the great example of the tradition in its most faithful and successful form. And strangely enough, Shane also contained the element of pursuit. Early in Shane, we realize that he is in flight, but we are never told from what. At the end of the picture, Shane moves on, still pursued, but by what we are not told. The Fugitive was a long time in gestation. My aim was to capture the essence of the Western in a contemporary setting. My confidence in the basic theory was boundless, but a truly workable solution did not come easily. In these regimented and conformist times, the protagonist had to be unregimented, apart from society, rootless, immune to permanent human commitment, and ever on the move. And we had to understand precisely why this was so, and to accept it with no uneasy sense of guilt. Otherwise, there would be a rejection of the protagonist and the concept. The Fugitive met all those needs and more. Richard Kimball is guilty by act of law, but innocent in fact. As a fugitive, he is compelled to live in a drifting, alienated way. And the specifics will be spelled out dramatically from episode to episode. Here they are. One, he must change his appearance, and he does. This purposeful loss of identity is one of our most deep-seated fantasies. It is found in countless children's stories and in equally countless sophisticated novels. The Moon and Sixpence, The Art of Llewellyn Jones, The Count of Monte Cristo, ad infinitum. Two, he must keep moving. To stay in one place over long is to multiply geometrically the dangers of recognition and apprehension. He finally adopts an arbitrary rule against staying in any given locale for more than 6 weeks. He must stay in this country. Here he is one American among nearly 200 million Americans. Outside our borders, passports are required. Questions are asked. He is the conspicuous stranger. Four, he can take only unusual, no-questions-asked jobs. An ordinary job requires letters of recommendation, a social security number, often even a fingerprint check. This necessity, of course, opens the door in a natural and credible way to a vast store of exciting and fresh story material. 5. He cannot make friendships that are not ended or fall in love without heartbreak. In terms of the needs of a weekly series, the storytelling advantages in this are obvious and infinite. Because the thematic base of the series is so explicit and yet so much a part of the unconscious yearnings of the broadest possible spectrum of the audience, the actual story content of each episode can and should be on the most sophisticated level possible in television. Implicit in each episode is the ultimate in sympathy for the protagonist and the never-ending presence of jeopardy. Therefore, the episodes can be built around character and premise. This brief presentation has left a multitude of questions unanswered, but not because they are unanswerable. For example, is he being searched for? Yes. One man in the state's attorney's office has been assigned that task, and at least one episode, and probably more than one, will deal with the pursuit itself. The story of Jean Valjean as Javert has not remained a classic for insignificant reasons, and the best will be distilled from those reasons. Does he ever meet anyone who will recognize him? Yes, and at least one episode will be built around it. Questions of this kind will lend themselves to answers in terms of dramatic treatment. An element that will be used in the series, but only in the most limited way, is the faint, almost unacknowledged hope in Richard Kimball that he might one day come face to face with the gaunt, red-haired man he had so briefly seen on the night of his wife's death. The reason for this is obvious. This will be a series which will be brought to a planned conclusion. That conclusion being, of course, Richard Kimball's release from his predicament and the ultimate salvation of justice. Obviously, after hearing that presentation, there were some changes in the series. And the major one was that I had really not planned to emphasize the fact of pursuit. His jeopardy, of course, was something you couldn't avoid. But I had not planned to emphasize the pursuit itself, and the presentation indicates that. I believe that the decision that was made later to emphasize the pursuit was, of course, a very good one. As a matter of fact, the motion picture of The Fugitive could not have been made, or at least a motion picture like that one could not have been made if it weren't for the importance that had been given to the pursuer. Otherwise, the series, I think, reflects quite closely the presentation that I wrote so many years ago.
Well, as you can tell, having just read the book, or heard the book, as the case may be, everyone who was involved with The Fugitive remembers it with very deep affection and great fondness, and I think that's because of, as Barry calls him, our dear David. It was a happy experience, and it's such a thrill for all of us who were involved with it that there's a whole new generation that's enjoying it just as much as we did when we shot it the first time around, what is it now, 30 years ago? Oh, my gosh.
Well, there you have it. The Fugitive Recaptured. And the process of recording these thoughts for all of you, some old friends I know, and even more younger, new friends, has conjured up a whole wealth of wonderful memories for me. It was a time when my family and I all too often were separated. And I remember that I had to use this very process of little cassette recordings to send messages, because they were quicker and easier to make than writing long letters, to Sydney, my wife, and to our daughter, Melanie, and our son, Hayward. They were, at this time, mostly in London, because our two youngsters were then studying at the Royal Academy of Dramatic Art to become actors, just as I'd studied at the Royal Academy of Dramatic Art to try and become an actor all those years ago. And so the remembrance of those years, 1963 to 1966, is a very warm one. And even though I grew to become probably the most fiercely hated character on television in those days, it was something that in an ironical way I was really quite proud of. But I was even more proud of the kind of company that I kept. I've often said to my children when they were younger, I still do sometimes, be very careful of the company you keep, not only personally, but professionally. Try and make sure that, so far as you have any choice in the matter, you make the best choices. And I feel myself very much gratified to have been drawn into a project which has turned out to be so durably popular and which has shown itself by my definition of a classic. After all, what do we call a classic? A classic is simply something, I think, which has continued to be popular to succeeding generations. That's why William Shakespeare is still the bestseller on earth. He's become a classic over 400 years. Well, we here in The Fugitive have become, in a minor way, a classic over these recent 30 years. So it's a joy to be able to bring something, I hope, of the flavour and character of that fine old series to you, new friends. Our best to you all.